Seven. One of the seven of the nine guys out there who have started all four for Monmouth so far this year. As a 2-0 is a called strike on the outside part of the plate, 2-1. And you know what? You know, talking about guys who are starting for every game so far, Delaware has changed up their lineup a lot.
Six different lineups in the six games they have played. That maybe it's just feeling it out. You see a lot of people. There's actually, this is a new lineup, so this is the seventh consecutive game
seven
with a new
for
lineup.
7-7. Yeah, Delaware coming in at 3-3, so I guess Coach Jim Sherman in his 13th year, not completely sure what he wants to do quite yet. That 3-1 is drilled to right field. On the run goes Cameron Travellini, makes the grab, and we have one away.
Cameron Travellini, another one of those players, hasn't seen much time this year, but he's getting a chance. Another one of those lineup shakeups by Coach Jim Sherman.
Yeah, he played quite a bit last year, but I guess, you know, like you said, some shakeups. Mm-hmm. No one's really sure where they're going to be on a consistent basis, so we see Cameron in right field this afternoon. Now stepping up for Monmouth is Kyle Perry, the catcher. And the first pitch to him is hit on the ground in between first and second. Going over to get it was Jimmy Ezzo, the first baseman. He could not get it to Chad Cool in time. And that will be a reach on an error.
And even if Chad Cool was able to field that, it would have been a bang-bang play. It was kind of a seeing-eye single even before.
They're actually going to rule that one a hit.
They are.
Okay, so... So Monmouth gets on with their first hit. They have a runner on first, and that brings up Jake Grunsky, the second baseman.
And talking about lineup shakes, one person who was almost involved in that play was cut off in front of him. DJ Long has kind of been a model of consistency for the University of Delaware Blue Hens, this being his 169th consecutive start.
As Kulika said, yeah, DJ Long has definitely paid his dues for the Blue Hens as the check swing is called a strike. 0-1.
He has been a starter in every single game he's participated in as a Delaware Blue Hen, this being his fourth and final season.
And we'll talk about that double play duo in a moment, because him and Brock Niggerberger have actually played quite a few games now next to each other, as Cool gets set with the 0-1. This is a grounder down the third baseline, foul. Brings the count to 0-2, but him and Niggerberger have played over 60 games together up the middle.
60 consecutive games together.
Yeah, and they've turned 41 double plays, so they've definitely got that down to a science.
They're definitely one of the premier middle infields in the CAA coming into today.
We have Jake Grunsky at the plate with the 0-2 count. He steps in. Kyle Perry leads off first as they check him. Slides back, no harm, no foul.
Grunsky comes into today batting 200. Through 10 at-bats, starting all four of Monmouth's games.
As Cool delivers, the 0-2 called, strike three on the swing.
And he will have to go sit down with his teammates.
Yes, he will. Two outs for Monmouth. And that's going to bring up Chris Parrott, the first baseman, the cleanup hitter for the Monmouth Hawks.
Parrott comes in batting only 154 to today's game. See if he's able to shake that off a little bit today.
Perry again leading off first. Cool gets set, delivers, first pitch called strike right down Main Street, and it's 0-1. Cool seeming to work quickly. You see, you have Parrott stepping out of the box looking to slow him down, but it's a cold day, especially for a pitcher. You're going to want to work quick, you want to stay warm. And Cool delivers the 0-1. It's going to miss low, 1-1.
With the little mishandle there at first base, he's already out there a little bit longer than he would like to be. He's definitely trying to get in and out of these innings as quickly as possible.
His last outing, he went 7 2/3. So he's used to going long, deep into games, rather. And so the short innings are definitely going to help him.
He is definitely.
The 1-1, runner goes. It's chopped on the ground. Foul out of play. So the count will go to 1-2. As Perry will jog back to first.
The Blue Hens are definitely looking for Cool to be a workhorse this season. They're going to look him to eat innings and give them quality starts basically every time he takes the mound.
Yeah, that's what you expect. Your number one guy, as Coach Sherman has said, this is their number one guy. This is who they expect to carry them throughout this season, be that kind of, like you said, the workhorse in the rotation, and pull them out of slumps or keep winning streaks going, and that's what you need. Before this 1-2, checks back over to Yezzo. Make sure Kyle Perry stays in place.
They're definitely giving Perry a lot of respect out there in the base paths. Cool is giving him a lot of attention, checking over there quite often.
And here we go, the 1-2 from Cool. Called strike three.
Got him.
And down goes Parrott, and that'll be the end of the top half of the first. Coming up on the other side is the Delaware Blue Hens, but keep it right here. Make sure if you want more Blue Hens to follow the Hens on Twitter and get live updates and scores on Twitter at twitter.com/UDBlueHens.
Really?
If you already have the Twitter, you could just search Delaware Athletics. It comes up. But now let's talk about Delaware coming up for their top three. Joe Giacchino, the left fielder, DJ Long, and Jimmy Yezzo. Jimmy Yezzo is coming in on fire. This kid is coming in on a 17-game hit streak dating back to May 12th of last season, 2012, and he has just been outstanding.
Yezzo, he's been in the zone recently. He's the team leader this season in batting average, runs, doubles, triples, total bases, on-base percentage, and slugging percentage. So needless to say, he is their offensive star.
The only thing he's
star.
Not leading in is ERA, and that's not even an offensive category.
And if they let him pitch, he might be, actually.
He might be. Yeah, absolutely an outstanding job.
Yeah, he has absolutely been dominating opposing pitchers this season. He is an incredible talent out there in the batter's box, and we will see him batting third this inning.
Yeah, absolutely, and it's Joe Giacchino, the left fielder.
Joe Giacchino.
Giacchino. I'm not getting it right. I'm trying to get hints from the guys in the box here. I'm not getting it right. But okay, we'll figure it out by the time he actually gets to the plate. But now let's look at the defensive setup for Monmouth going around. You have Andrew McGee, like we said, 0-1 with a 6.75 ERA on the hill. Kyle Perry is behind the dish. Chris Parrott, the first baseman. Jake Grunsky playing second. John Guida at short. Owen Stewart at third. And then from left to right in the outfield, you have Steve Wilgus, Joe Bamford, and Dan Shea.
Now, leading off this inning is Joe Giacchino, as you mentioned. He's a very interesting player for the University of Delaware. He had his first home run just this past series against Virginia Tech of his career. And he's actually recovered from a brain tumor, which is a pretty impressive feat to get back on a baseball field after battling something that serious.
Yeah, he actually has a tremendous story. I remember seeing that video actually on Hens All Access.
Hens All Access.
That documented his incredible journey back. From, like you said, from the tumor and from his surgeries.
Be sure to check that out on Hens All Access in the archives online, bluehens.com.
we'll get plenty of plugs in for Hens All Access throughout this one, but here we go. The first pitch from McGee is a called strike on the outside corner, and Giacchino is down 0-1. Once again, this is Delaware's home opener as the crowd, well, they're slowly, I guess.
they're filing in.
As the 0-1 is outside, 1-1. Yeah, we'll just say filing in. We'll go with that.
They're filing in. They are.
They'll get here.
Trickling in.
They'll get here. As Giacchino waits on the 1-1. McGee gets set and delivers. This is outside, 2-1.
Definitely looks as if Giacchino is trying to see pitches here. Definitely having a very selective eye as the first batter of the game.
Giacchino, unlike Cool, is not the one starter coming out of Monmouth. As this one's hit on the ground to second, Grunsky fields cleanly, throws over to first, and there is one away. Chris Parrott makes the catch over first base, and that'll bring up DJ Long.
I'm very excited to see DJ Long. He is he had the longest hit streak in University of Delaware history as a freshman, coming in at 30 games, and he is just a contact hitter, gets on base a lot, and really sets the table for these big hitters coming up later on in the inning.
So Long steps in, and here we go. The first pitch from McGee is drilled back behind home plate. Foul. 0-1. Yeah, like you said, DJ Long, I mean, we talked about it in the top half of the inning. He's been with Delaware. He's played every single game since his freshman year. And he has been the offensive workhorse, if you will, for Delaware, just constantly, putting forth as much as he could and showing up every day.
He is Mr. Consistency for these Delaware Blue Hens over his 4 years here, and that will look to continue this year as a senior as he fouls another back.
Yeah, that'll bring it to 1-2.
DJ Long, another, as so many of these Delaware baseball players is a local product. He's from Delaware, from down in South Delaware, went to Sussex Central High School. Just another Delaware product doing big things for the University of Delaware Blue Hens.
As the 1-2 to Long is a called strike three on the outside corner. He doesn't like it. Like you said, that'll make a second out of the inning. But like you said, he's one of Delaware's own, and there are 12 kids on this Delaware Blue Hens team that are from the first state, and that is, it's leading the Hens for most state. There's 9 from Jersey, I believe,
yep.
And I think 1 from Maryland, 1 from California. They're kind of spread out all over the place. But Delaware has made their presence known. They obviously love that in-house recruiting. As this brings up Jimmy Yezzo riding the 17-game hit streak.
This is who we are waiting to see, Jimmy Yezzo, the leading hitter in almost every category for the Blue Hens.
as he takes that first pitch outside for a ball. The second one will miss low and away, 2-0.
McGee is being very, very careful with Yezo here, trying to paint the corners, not giving him anything to hit.
Listen, the bottom line is when you have somebody coming in with a 17-game hit streak, he's obviously feeling it. He's obviously got a great swing going on. You're not going to need to pitch to him as he chops this one over to second. Grunsky fields and throws to first.
So that'll be a 1-2-3 inning for the Blue Hens. Get up and sit down.
I was saying they don't need to pitch to him, and he takes care of it for us. So with that, we'll send it back to Hens All Access. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Hens All Access, Blue Hen Baseball home opener, as the Hens are taking on the Monmouth Hawks. After one, a scoreless first, a 1-2-3 for the Delaware side. And Monmouth will be up at the plate as John Guida will be stepping in the shortstop.
Yes, he will. On the mound we have Chad Kuhl, again the number one draft prospect in the CAA by Baseball America. So real excited to watch him get back to work out there on the mound.
As Kuhl gets set to start this second inning, the first pitch is check swing, strike one. And I'll bring the count to 0-1. On deck, you have Danny Avella, the designated hitter, followed by Owen Stewart, the third baseman. Owen's a called strike for Kuhl, so he's quickly ahead 0-2.
And this is where he's really just been a dominant pitcher so far these past 2 years. When he gets ahead in the count, he is very hard to get a hit off of.
He already 7 strikeouts on the season. He misses the 0-2 outside.
He's also leading the team in innings pitched with 13.2, so he's been doing his job.
It's been a workhorse
season. He's been doing his job.
And the 1-2 from Kuhl is just outside, maybe a little low, and it'll bring the count even at 2-2. Kuhl gets set. The 2-2 misses way outside. The count runs full. 3-2. And, you know, like we talked about in the first inning, he's going to want to work quickly. This is, like we said over and over again, Delaware's workhorse. You want a lot of innings out of him. You have an 0-2 count. You can't let it work all the way back to full and not even have the hitter, you know, kind of do it on his own. But the 3-2 is chopped. A high chopper over to third. And a quick throw, not in time, as Ryan Hartley came charging in for the Hens.
And Yezo obviously did not like that call. Almost threw it into around the horn after catching the chopper throw. But
yeah, it was a tough play for Hartley. It was hit clearly very high up in the air. Hartley just kind of had to wait for it to come down. You almost thought Kuhl was going to try to make a play on it. But just not enough time, and the hustle from Guida made it pay off. And now they have a leadoff man on first. And that brings up Danny Avella,
the designated hitter. So always dangerous hitter when he's been designated by the coach to be just that.
To do just that. Guida leads off first. Kuhl delivers the first pitch. A called strike. Gets the high and away corner. Count Kuhl goes to 0-1.
Kuhl again showing a lot of attention to the runner over at first base.
The 0-1 from Kuhl is hit on the ground as a error is going to make everybody safe. Hartley couldn't handle it.
Hartley involved in 2 consecutive plays in the infield and didn't get any outs. That's what you can't do as a Delaware Blue Hen.
Yeah, and Hartley's actually filling in for EJ Stoltzfus, who's just getting the afternoon off, not the normal third baseman for the Blue Hens. But obviously he's kind of wishing he was on the bench right about now.
He's wishing he could have at least converted one of those two, if not both. But now he's got Kuhl in a little bit of a jam here with no outs and 2 runners on.
And that's going to bring up Owen Stewart, the third baseman. Like you said, 2 runners on here, no outs for Chad Kuhl, so he's going to have to come up with something clever if he wants to get out of this inning with no marks on him.
Stewart comes in with one RBI in the season. Kuhl is going to try and prevent him from adding to that total with a runner in scoring position.
Kuhl gets set and delivers. They show bunt. They pull back. But it's a called strike. And Kuhl gets up 0-1.
A bunt would be a kind of traditional play here, so we'll see if Monmouth decides to let Stewart lay one down.
Yeah, it would be expected. You know, you could play small ball early on here, still in a 0-0 ball game. As Kuhl delivers the 0-1, this time they get the bunt. It's popped up in the air. Kuhl can't get to it in the air, and he's going to have no play. As Chad Kuhl tried to make a diving play to catch it in the air,
Kuhl was
kind of stumbled.
Kuhl was kind of caught in between there. He didn't know if he should dive, if he should try and play it off the bounce. Ended up kind of just going to his knees without really making a play on the ball. So all runners safe, bases loaded, no outs. Kuhl finds himself in an early jam.
Yeah, and that's going to bring up Dan Shea, the right fielder. So a tough spot for Kuhl here early in a 0-0 ball game. He has, like you said, bases loaded, nobody out. Dan Shea at the plate. Joe Bamford is on deck, and then Monmouth gets back to the top.
Shea comes into the game hitless on the season. So
I guess if you ever want somebody up with bases loaded, Delaware's got their guy right here. Kuhl gets set. First pitch fouled straight back on one.
Kuhl is not shying away from the situation at all. That was a power pitch driven inside on Shea.
Yeah, that was frustration. You could see it there. I mean, he was not happy with how that last play went. Like you said, the in-betweener just kind of caught him off guard. And now he's got himself in quite a jam.
Three balls. None of them have left the infield. All three safe for singles. This is not how the Delaware Blue Hens need to play defense.
As the 0-1 is a called strike, 0-2. So Kuhl gets ahead early. And they always say the first out's the hardest one to get. So if you can get this one, you can kind of alleviate a lot of the pressure because the double play ball could end it in. Kuhl gets set. The 0-2. Called strike three. So taking care of business, Chad Kuhl, the three-pitch strikeout. Has Dan Shea going back to the bench with the bat on the shoulder. And I'll bring up Joe Bamford, the center fielder, the nine hitter. So this is definitely a big opportunity for Delaware.
I think that is why Kuhl is such a – having the pro prospect salivate over him a little bit. He gets caught in a situation like that, doesn't flinch, just settles down, gets the next out, and hopefully he'll get another one here.
Yeah, well, now with one out, the double play ball gets you out of the jam. You don't got to worry about any run scoring or anything like that. So let's see how Kuhl responds.
Especially with that premier middle infield that we talked about earlier back there, converting so many double plays. It'd be a great time to see one of those.
Kuhl gets set, a called strike. Right down the middle, so now he's working a little quicker. You can see it in his timing. He's definitely looking to pick up the pace quite a bit. Gets right back to the rubber with the 0-1 count.
This inning cannot get over quick enough for Chad Kuhl.
As Kuhl gets set, the 0-1 is drilled in the gap to right, to shallow right, rather. Coming on is Travellini. He can't make the catch. One run will score, make that two. And Monmouth strikes first. It's going to be a double for Joe Bamford. Two runs score from Monmouth. And Monmouth strikes first with a 2-0 lead here in the top of the second.
And Monmouth is finding the players that don't play very often. Right field is typically Nick Ferdinand's domain. He's been there, you know, for seasons, and he's not out there.
Another one just getting a day off.
Bloop single, just getting a day off in the bloop single. Maybe he gets to it, maybe he doesn't, but that is his traditional domain.
And, you know, that's also a situation where you have the bases loaded. You could have DJ Long playing a little bit further back. He has to cheat over because of the double play situation. So it's just a lot of things not working in the Hens' favor on that last play and allowed it to just kind of fall in the best place possible.
So the first baseball out of the infield this inning is a bloop single.
You checked, actually only one run scored, not two. So the bases are still loaded for Kuhl. And this one's hit on the ground past Niggerberga at short into left field. And with that, another run will score. So now it is 2-0 for Monmouth. As that base hit was by Steve Wilgus, the left fielder, the leadoff man. And I'll now bring up the catcher, Kyle Perry.
Kuhl is not looking sound. He's looking a little frustrated on the mound now. Again, bases loaded. It's a tough situation, but he's a veteran. He'll be able to get out of it.
Kyle Perry steps up, the catcher. 0 for 1 on the day.
Perry came into today 294, so that's lowered a little bit, but it's still solid hitter, not who you would like up in the situation.
As he shows bunt, can't get it fair, so the count will run to 0-1.
Not only is it rare to have a catcher batting second, but it's also incredibly rare to have a catcher try to squeeze a run home. That's pretty incredible for catchers who are normally not the fleetest of foot.
Yeah, exactly. It's not even like you have first base open, so you have a lot of opportunities for Delaware to make defensive plays if you do actually lay this one down in fair territory. But I guess they trust the speed over there at third base. The 0-1 misses outside. Count goes even to 1-1.
Cool is working methodically now. Not as fast, but he's still all about his business.
It's Cool with the 1-1, one out. It's always just one pitch away now with this one out, the double play in effect.
But again, like you said, that creates a lot of holes. The middle infielders have to play in.
Right, and even that last base hit, Niggerberger had to shield over towards second because of the double play that was in effect. It kind of left that big gap between him and third base. And they're finding the holes early here in the second inning.
A lot of seeing eye hits early on for the Monmouth Hawks.
Cool gets set with the 2-1. Misses outside. Bases loaded here for Monmouth in the top of the second. 2-0 Hawks lead as Cool delivers. And that is a called strike on the 3-1.
Wow.
So that'll run the count full.
Looked like it might have been a little inside, but the umpire doesn't agree. And
Perry started heading towards first. He thought he had himself a little RBI on the walk. But now
bases,
Cool.
Bases
now
loaded, full count.
Yeah, now Cool in a big situation. The 3-2, Cool delivers, and that's going to miss. So that will send Perry to first. Another run will come across for Monmouth, and they now lead 3-0 here in the top of the second inning.
This is the fourth consecutive batter that comes to the plate for the Monmouth Hawks with bases loaded.
Yeah, that'll bring up Jake Gronsky, the second baseman for Monmouth. Again, still bases loaded, still just one out.
And this is where I want to see Burgess, the catcher, go out, talk to his pitcher, settle him down a little bit, let him know that it's still early, make his pitches, and look it out of this jam and move on with the game.
The issue now is you have somebody who's supposed to be your workhorse. There's always the mental aspect with that. When your catcher comes out as he gets that first called strike over the outside part of the plate. But you know what? If you're Chad Cool, you want to feel like you could settle this yourself. So the catcher goes out there. You could possibly get mentally rocked early on in the second inning.
And this also isn't his traditional catcher, Ty Warrington, getting the day off as well. Again, a lot of Blue Hens getting the day off today.
As the 0-1 is a called strike, 2 across the outside. And yeah, I mean, a lot of Hens getting rested. It is the home opener, but I guess it's still non-conference play, so you rest them when you can.
It's still the seventh game of the season. They've been out there playing for 6 games already. As you said, non-conference. You have to get your rest early in the season.
It's questionable, though, because they've had a lot of time. Their last game was against Virginia Tech. It was back on Monday. Mm-hmm. So they've had plenty of rest. I mean, you can rest a full pitching staff between now and then. But I guess Coach Sherman decided otherwise.
And at 3-3, maybe he's just trying to shake things up, let some players know that, you know, everyone can play, and everyone here is a college baseball player, even the guy behind you on the depth chart.
And the 1-2 is hit on the ground to Long at second. The flip over to Niggerbugger at short, and he bounces it in the dirt. Yezo can't pick it up at first, so that'll bring the second out, but not the third. And that'll lead to another couple of runs for Monmouth. 2 more across the plate on that one. And the lead now extends to 5-0 for the Hawks here in the top of the second inning.
This defense is very shaky early on.
That was just sloppy, and you know what? The three guys involved are regular everyday starters, so there's actually no excuse on that one.
we've been talking about the players filling in for others, but all three of those are premier players in this, not only for the Blue Hens, but in the CAA, all extremely good defensive players.
So Chad Cool has now had to get about 6 outs this inning, and we'll see if he can finally send the Blue Hens back to the bats. He said he just didn't even run the bases. He just, like, stopped. First pitch, a swinging strike on Chris Parrott.
Cool is waiting in his stance for the batter to get back into, for Chris Parrott to get back in the box. He is definitely ready to get this inning over with.
Cool gets set. The 0-1 is chopped on the ground to Yezo at first. Cool will come over to cover, and this time they pull it off, and they end the inning. So after an inning and a half, it is 5-0 in favor of Monmouth. And make sure to become a fan on Facebook for post-game videos, pictures, stories, and much, much more. That's at facebook.com/DelawareBlueHens. And, of course, you can always check Hens All Access for all the great videos and interviews as well.
The good part about that inning for Chad Cool, if there is a silver lining, is that with the errors, his ERA won't be tainted that much because almost none of
that
them
is true.
Will earn.
That's true, but to the extent where you are the workhorse, you have a long season ahead of you. Like you said, this is only their 7th game. They play, I mean, all in all, near 50 games this season. If you go into the CAA tournament, this guy should be able to pitch about 15 to 20 of them. Mm-hmm. you don't want extended innings like that, especially in this cold weather early in the season. Put additional strain on the pitchers, and it's just never pretty.
When you look at the first three batters, all reaching first base, none of them hitting it out of the infield, it is one of those things where, you know, if the defense could give him some help, maybe he'd be out of there a little bit earlier.
Yeah, he actually got two earned runs in that inning out of the five that were scored. So like you said, they don't all count towards him, but still, it's not exactly where you want to be if you're Delaware, especially after that 1-2-3 inning in the bottom of the first. We'll see if they can get the bats going. Two up for the Hens. We have Tyler Powell, the left fielder, Zach Lopes in the designated hitter spot, and Cameron Travellini, the right fielder.
Now, Tyler Powell is coming off a CAA all-rookie team performance last season. He's yet to really find his groove this season, but we know he's a good hitter. Coach Sherman has confidence in him, and we'll see what he can do as he steps into the box right now.
So here we go. Tyler Powell is up at the plate. On the mound for his second inning of work is Andrew McGee. And Powell fouls that first one back out of play, 0-1. McGee, like we said, able to get that 1-2-3 inning on the Hens, first time out.
But he's been on the bench in this cold weather for a while, too, with that long inning by his offense. So we'll see if that's affected him at all.
As a chopper over to second base, fielded by Grunsky, he throws to Parrott at first, and there is one away. And I was just going to actually get to that. He's been on the bench for a while, but nothing would be better for Monmouth than another quick 1-2-3 to get the bats going again, because clearly, I mean, everybody got up that inning. So you'd love to see them get back up and get a chance. Well, for their sake, you'd love to see them get back up and get another chance at it.
Momentum is definitely on their side, and they want this defensive inning to halt their momentum as little as possible.
Now up at the plate is Zach Lopes for Delaware. He's DHing today. Again, another non-everyday player for the Hens getting his turn this afternoon. He's going to lay one down the third baseline. It's going to be fielded by Stewart, and he's going to throw it well wide at first base. It's going to roll into foul territory down by right field, and Lopes will slide on over to second as he reaches with the hit and then the error as he extends to second base.
So maybe sloppy play in the infield is going to become the theme of this game. There are a lot of balls being thrown around the infield and not many very accurately.
Yeah, I mean, Delaware actually has an all-grass field. Considering how the weather has been, it could definitely be playing a part in it. You looked at, you know, the high choppers before. You look at this one, the slow roller off the bunt. It's tough to come up. The grass is obviously wet. There's clearly other factors that are coming into here. So that could definitely be, you know, what's giving the infield so much trouble early on.
Two bunts in the first two innings reaching for base hits.
It's going to fall on the ground. It's an easy score there for Lopes. Just kind of fell along. He's going to head towards third. He's going to slide in safely. So Travellini, first pitch, drives into right center. And the Hens get their first run on the board and their first big hit of the afternoon.
Travellini is one of those guys that hasn't been too much taking advantage of his opportunity and absolutely ripping a shot to right center.
Yeah, there was no doubt about that one. He got all of it. And that is going to be the second hit for Delaware, but their first hit out of the infield. And that's going to bring up Ryan Hartley, the third baseman for Delaware. Andrew Burgess, catcher's on deck.
And just like you said, the first out's always the hardest. The first hit, first real good driven ball is always the hardest. And now they see that this pitcher isn't invincible, and hopefully they can string together a little run.
Yep. And if nothing else, it keeps Monmouth out on the field for a little bit longer. Kind of slows down their momentum offensively as well.
And another runner in scoring position, which is always a good situation to be in.
Right, traveling in there, leads off third. And McGee gets set. First pitch misses well outside. That brings the count to 1-0. One out here, runner on third. Hens trail 5-1 to the Monmouth Hawks.
Hartley's in the box has been involved in a lot of defensive plays. He definitely wants to get his action seen on offense as well.
As a big cut there by Hartley is a swing to miss. Evens the count of 1-1.
McGee's looked good so far, but the first real chink in his armor a little bit has been that triple by Travellini. Let's see how it's affected him.
He gets set on the 1-1, and that is going to be called. Ooh, call strike on the outside part of the plate. I'm taking a little extra time there making that decision.
And Hartley did not agree.
That brings the count to 1-2. The last thing you want is to strand Travellini at third base. And so if you are Hartley, you just got to put this ball in play, if nothing else. And with that, wow. A nasty cutter. Gets him on the inside part of the plate, and that's going to be a called strike three. So that is the second out. Andrew Burgess, the catcher, steps up for Delaware. And now you're kind of in a little bit more of a pressure situation if you're Burgess, because you have a runner on third. He had a great job driving it into the gap. You do not want to strand him there down 5-1.
You're already down four. You need to get Travellini across the plate, cut into the lead a little bit, set it up for a less of a comeback later on in the game.
first pitch is called inside. Wow, Leonoff is liking the inside part of the plate.
He is absolutely pounding the inside part of the plate, and the Delaware Blue Hens are going to have to adjust.
Well, he's definitely getting some help, I'd say that. But it is an 0-1 count as Burgess sits waiting on McGee. This one's hit up the middle of the second. It's going to be fielded by Grunsky. Throws over to first in time. And so Travellini is stranded. And Delaware is able to drive one across, but they leave one left on. And we'll be back with the top of the third inning right after this. Con los terroristas. Welcome back in to Bob Hanna Stadium here as we get set for the top of the third inning. Delaware able to strike one. As you know, they kind of cut into the deficit a little bit, trailing Monmouth 5-1 now as we head to the third. Now, Tim, what are you seeing from Delaware's offense here early on? Because that first inning was 1-2-3. Second inning, Travellini was able to drive that ball into the right field gap to get that first run across, but they have no sort of consistency.
That's the major problem that you see here. The consistency just isn't there. You need to be able to string hits together to get runs across. Stranding Travellini on third after being there with one out is something that they can't allow to happen very often, especially if they want to come back from this four-run deficit they found themselves in.
It will do up for Monmouth is John Guida, the shortstop. He'll be followed by Danny Avella and then Owen Stewart.
And we'll see if Cool can settle himself down a little bit after giving up five in that last inning. We need to see Cool really settle down, throw the pitches that he knows he can make, and get out of this inning quickly, and maybe get Delaware some momentum and get their offense back on the field.
Yeah, I mean, Delaware definitely needs a quick inning. You can't, I mean, theoretically, you don't want them to score any runs, but if they're going to score, you got to get them quick. You got to get the bats back up. And, you know, coming up for Delaware, you'll have Brock Niggerberger and then back to the top of the order. So a lot of opportunities for Delaware to get back into this one early on as we get set for the start of the third. Cool delivers a called strike on the inside part of the plate, so he gets ahead quickly 0-1 to Guida. Oh, one is a called strike on the outside.
Cool has been ahead on batters all day today, and it's been a matter of really finishing him out. He's letting a couple battle back, get the count to even, get the count to 3-2, and that's something that he can't do.
Yeah, he's been in this 0-2 situation before as it misses, and there you go, just like we're talking about. He's been in this 0-2 situation before. He kind of lets batters back into counts on his own. It's not like they're fouling off and fighting. He's just kind of letting them back in.
He's trying to be too perfect with that strikeout pitch.
And this one is drilled high towards right field and foul, giving chases Travellini. He won't be able to get there, and it'll keep the count at 1-2.
Cool just has to throw his pitches. He's trying to be extremely perfect. He's trying to place the ball. He's almost aiming it. He just needs to rear back and throw it.
You said it perfectly. He's trying to be too perfect with that strikeout pitch. You get ahead 0-2, 1-2 as a pitcher. You get a lot of confidence, and it's obviously just becoming a little bit too much for him here in the early innings. As a 1-2 misses way outside. As Burgess had to slide out to catch that one. So it runs even 2-2. Now you kind of taking the pressure off the hitter. Guida doesn't have to be as picky. Doesn't have to look to defend as much because he knows, listen, Cool's not looking to get a full count right now. 2-2. Misses well outside. So
just like we're talking about, Cool is letting batters back into at-bats that they shouldn't be in. When you're up 0-2, you have to be able to slam the door.
So now the full count. Chad Cool gets set, delivers, and he catches a break. A swing strike three. And so Cool gets out of the mess as he sits Guida down. But that was a much longer bat than we needed.
Even though it is a strikeout and you love strikeouts, that is a 7-8 pitch strikeout, which should have been a 4 or 5 pitch strikeout. The pitch count is getting up there, and it doesn't have to.
So that'll bring up Danny Avella, the designated hitter, up to the plate for Monmouth. One out, nobody on. And again, called strike one. So a great job by Cool getting ahead. And now we're going to see how he responds with Avella, if he can keep what he's doing on the first couple pitches and kind of use it through the entire at-bat. The 0-1 nicks the corner, 0-2.
Yet again, he's up 0-2 on the count. This might be a strategy in Monmouth. They might be trying to just see a lot of pitches and kind of wear him down a little bit, I mean, knowing that he's their
best. That's the basic strategy when you face a team's ace, the team's number one guy. You try to get him to throw a lot of pitches, and here you go. The 0-2 is in the dirt, so it runs to 1-2. But, yeah, I mean, if you're Monmouth, you're coming in against a team who obviously is not as tough as your last outing. They just came off a number two Vanderbilt. And so if you're going to face an ace, you're going to have him throw a lot of pitches. And this one is popped up into shallow left. Stepping back is Hartley in foul territory. He's going to make the grab, and that'll be two away. And so Cool at least able to not force a full count again.
When the Kemp gets to 0-2, he has to make them at least think about swinging. I don't think I've seen a Monmouth Hawk take the bat off his shoulder in an 0-2 count, and that just can't happen. He has to really force the issue, especially when you're in a situation where you're already down 5-1.
He has Owen Stewart, the third baseman, stepping up. You have Dan Shea, who is the only one who's gone down on three pitches. Dan Shea went down on the 1-2-3 in the second inning. The first pitch is over for a called strike. But, yeah, other than that, every time he gets ahead 0-2, it runs to 1-2, 2-2, and in some cases even the full count. The 0-1 from Cool is fouled back 0-2. So let's see if he can get a quick inning for the Hens here. They'd love to get the bats going once again.
All three batters, he's able to get up two strikes and no balls. So we'll see if he's able to slam the door here on Shea like he did earlier in the game.
This would be a statement for him, again, coming off a tough second inning as the 0-2 is fouled back. Now you let up five runs in an inning, you come back with a 1-2-3. That's definitely kind of settling down in a big way.
He's been trying to be perfect on those 0-2 pitches. That one, he made Shea look like an absolute fool with that swing. Barely getting a piece on it, all off balance. That was a great pitch by Cool.
Tim Donnelly has called you out, sir. As the 0-2 is a called strike three on the outside part of the plate. And we will head to the bottom of the third. Remember, check out Blue Hens Beat, our biweekly web show dedicated to everything Delaware athletics with features, highlights, interviews, and more. Blue Hens Beat will give you behind the scenes, will give you the behind the scenes you need. Look for a new episode now on bluehens.com. All right, so now we have Delaware coming up. They have their ninth hitter in Brock Niggerbrugge, the shortstop. He'll get his first turn, and then we go back to the top with Jaquino and DJ Long. And you know, if you're Delaware, like we said, they bounce back. That was a great defensive inning for Chad Cool and even Ryan Hartley, who got to make a play to kind of save himself from that second inning. But now you got to get the bats going. You stranded Cameron Travellini on third base. You really haven't done too much damage to McGee. This is your opportunity. This is not a great pitcher on the mound in Andrew McGee.
Yeah, this is their opportunity, exactly how you said it. The top of the lineup's coming back up. Niggerbrugge has the speed, if he does get on base, to advance things and make things happen. You have to get to McGee when the top of the lineup gets back up here. You're already down four runs. You have to make a dent in that early. You don't want to go into the later innings where the Blue Hens have struggled in the later innings. You don't want to go into the later innings already with a deficit.
Absolutely, but here we go. Niggerbrugge is we're not getting ready to go at all. The catcher's heading out to the mound. Kyle Perry's going to talk it over with McGee, make sure he's ready to go. That was a much shorter break for him this time around.
Come on, here you go.
And so here we go.
Right, McGee, come on.
Delaware trailing Monmouth 5-1 in their home opener. As Niggerbrugge steps in.
And Niggerbrugge has the speed to make some things happen on the base path. Let's see if he's able to get there.
First pitch is a called strike.
Maybe the Hens are going to try and see a few more of McGee's pitches here, too. They've been real aggressive early, and maybe they should take a page out of Monmouth's book, who's seen a ton of pitches from Chad Cool.
And the 0-1 is hit to dead center field. Bamford will just sit under it and make the catch. And so a quick two-pitch out for Andrew McGee. And you know what? If you can work quickly like that, you're going to be in good shape, and you're going to go deep into this ballgame.
That was a quick out, but it was a good swing by Niggerbrugge. He got solid wood on it, something that they haven't really been able to do aside from the Travellini triple on McGee. So, you know, a good swing.
Yeah, eventually those will start falling. But if you're Delaware, you don't need two pitch at-bats when your pitcher's been working very hard to get through three innings. So now stepping up is Joe Jaquino. He's going to hit this right off the ankle of McGee. It's going to roll towards the first baseman, and Jaquino will be safe. Parrott tried to almost peg him with the baseball, hoping that would get him out.
That was a little bit of a sandlot play flashback there. He tried to peg the runner. But Jaquino had the speed to elude not only the player, but also the ball.
They're going to rule it as a hit. And so Jaquino will be on first. DJ Long will step in now with a runner on first, one out.
And now you have to worry about the health of McGee, as that ball absolutely was rocked off his leg.
He took that right off the ankle on the comebacker. It did take one hop on the front of the mound, but not nearly enough time for him to actually get out of the way.
It looks like he's telling the trainer that it hit his cleat, and he's going to stay in with no delay.
He's a player. He's not going to tell him he's hurt. Let's be serious. You know exactly what that's like.
When you only get to take the mound once every couple days, you're not worried about getting brushed up by a little liner.
So he'll take a couple extra practice throws to make sure his ankle or foot is all right.
But again, it was a hard hit ball. The last couple batters have kind of been able to time up McGee.
Yeah.
Even Niggerbrugge's out to the outfield was a hard hit ball. That's a hard hit ball. Trevellini had the hard hit ball right before the end of the last inning. That's what the Blue Hens need. They need to be able to kind of time it up, and maybe they are.
Yes, Monmouth struck early. They got that five-run lead in the second inning. But it's a long ball game. You're only in the third. You only have one out in this third inning. So plenty of time for Delaware to piece together a good ball game here.
And the heart of the lineup's coming up. These are the people you want at the plate with people on base. Niggerbrugge's on first.
Yeah, Long takes that first pitch outside for the 1-0 count. Like I said, you have Chiquino on first as the 1-0 is fouled back.
That was 1-1. His pitch. That was a big cut by DJ Long. He had visions of putting that one over the left field fence.
He wanted it to be 5-3 real quick.
Yeah, he wanted to take a nice dent out of that deficit right here on one swing.
But on deck is Jimmy Ezzo, the one who we've been talking about, the hit streak, the stud on the offensive side for Delaware. And you know what, if you can get Long on base and kind of get somewhat of a rally going here, you would love to see him keep it going as Long pops this one very high up in the infield. Coming over is Parrott, just near the first baseline, will make the catch.
And as I look out into center field, I see the flag is whipping. That ball was up there and
quite a bit, yeah.
And it was moving. You saw the Monmouth players having to really struggle to stay under it. The wind may be a factor in this game.
Yeah, the wind will definitely be a factor. Like you said, I mean, even on Trevellini, he said that ball was carrying, and then it kind of hooked because of the wind. And you saw that. It started up in between the mound and first, and ended up working all the way into foul territory where Parrott eventually made the grab. But here we go. Jimmy Ezzo is at the plate. He has Chiquino at first, now two outs, as the Hens still trail 5-1 in the bottom of the third. A big swing from Ezzo on the high fastball.
That ball was up around his shoulders. He needs to be able to lay off of that.
Yeah, that was one of those that look real good and never are, as a high heater puts him behind 0-1.
He is still looking for a hit to extend that hitting streak that we've talked about.
As the 0-1 is a called strike, gets the outside part of the plate. So that left part of the plate is definitely working for McGee. As he is a lefty, so he's able to kind of come across and find the outside part. And if you could be effective like that, you're going to have a very good ball game on your hands.
He has been pounding it against righties and taking it outside against lefties. It's really that left side of the plate, like you mentioned.
And it called strike three. So Ezzo goes down three pitches looking. And with that, Monmouth escapes the third. So we will step aside. We will come back with the top of the fourth inning right after this.
It's my honor to introduce our new head coach, Dave Brock.
I'm going to love Delaware football. I'm confident that we have the building blocks in place to win in 2013 and forward. We'll be a program that the entire state will be proud of on and off the field. With this opportunity comes tremendous responsibility. I will fulfill that responsibility. Together we will. Thank you very much.
To 20 degrees. I'm standing up in the booth. I got my winter jacket on. Like, I'm freezing my ass off. Ooh. Welcome back in to Bob Hanna Stadium here as we head to the top of the fourth inning. Delaware trailing 5-1 after Chiquino reached first on the infield hit and then could not go anywhere from there. So Delaware still down by 4. Chad Cool out for his fourth inning of work, and we will see if they can again have a quick inning. But now we have some trivia for you. We're going to give you the question now, and it is: who is the career leader in home runs for the Blue Hens? The answer will be in the top of the fifth inning, and you could, you know, take some time thinking about that. He was definitely a big offensive powerhouse for Delaware.
I think I have an idea who it is, but I'm going to let everyone else think about it before I give my take on who the answer to that trivia question is.
As Cool gets ready to start the fourth inning, his first pitch is a ball inside. And yeah, you know the answer? Did it help that you looked at the sheet?
I think I knew it before I saw the sheet. I did see the sheet, but I'm confident in my abilities as a...
Confident in your abilities.
As All a right, trivia well. knowledge knower.
Cool's 1-0 pitch missed as well, 2-0. At the plate is Dan Shea, the right fielder for Monmouth, as the 2-0 pitch comes across 2-1.
For the first time, he's throwing a couple balls early in the count today.
Yeah, and Shea was actually the only one that helped Cool in that second inning. He went down on three pitches. And this one's chopped up the middle. Niederbrugger comes across, makes the play, throws to first. And a quick first out here in the top of the fourth. So Shea now is 0-2. Joe Bamford will come to the plate, the center fielder, and the number 9 hitter for Monmouth.
Infield was able to make a play there. It's been a lot of infield hits in this game. It's good to see them get a put out early in this inning. See if they can string a couple together. Maybe like get Cool some help behind him.
Yeah, Cool was able to get that quick third inning. He'd love to have another one just like it here in the fourth and kind of pretty much just erase that second inning and its effects altogether. First pitch to Bamford, fouled off down the left field line out of play. That's 0-1.
And Bamford has good speed, so any play that they do make at first, they're going to have to make a little quicker than usual.
Cool gets set. The other one is a called strike on the outside part, that infamous left corner.
That left corner.
It's becoming a big problem for both sides.
The umpire loves the left corner.
As the 1-1 is chopped on the ground to third. Tough hop, fielded by Hartley. Throws over, and it's well out of the reach of Jimmy Yezzo. That's going to head out of play. And Bamford will trot on over to second base. So Hartley not having a good afternoon here through 3+.
Cool is not getting much help behind him.
No.
Not many balls are leaving the infield, but runners just keep finding a way on base.
It's errors. I mean, it's going to kill you no matter where you're on the field, whether it's the infield or the outfield. And the problem here is that you basically had your second out right there. It was a great play to field the ball by Hartley, but he wasn't able to actually collect himself and make the good throw over to Yezzo. And now you have somebody on second with one out instead of nobody on with two, and that's just an entirely different ballgame.
It's almost like he was surprised that it found his glove on the short hop, that he didn't have time to compose himself and make a nice solid throw over to first.
Well, stepping up now is Steve Wilgus, the top of the order from Monmouth, the left fielder, as he takes the first pitch outside, 1-0.
And now you are going, barring a pretty incredible double play, you're going to see the second batter of the lineup. That error could prove pretty disastrous.
Cool delivers a 1-0 at called strike. Again, that outside part of the plate, 1-1, here with one out. Like you said, up next is Kyle Perry, the catcher, followed by Jake Grunsky, the second baseman. The 1-1 from Cool, he gets set, delivers. Wow, just misses on that 1-1. The count will go to 2-1. You kind of saw that Burgess held it there for an extra second to give the umpire a chance to change his mind. But he liked what he saw, or he didn't like what he saw, rather. Liked his call, and it'll go to 2-1.
You're starting to kind of see a theme here. All the little 50-50 plays, the 50-50 calls, not many are going the Blue Hens' way. And that's really what's added up to the 5-1 lead. There hasn't been any home runs. There hasn't been any dramatic base-clearing doubles. It's just been a lot of little plays.
You can't put it all on the umpire. Some of that 5-1 has been great defensive plays by Delaware. But, no, I absolutely agree. Definitely that corner has been a big storyline here so far, and a questionable one at that. But the 2-2 now hit towards right center, giving chase is Travellini. A great play by him to cover the gap there and make the catch. So that'll be a second out, and it'll actually keep Bamford at second.
That ball got hung up in the wind a little bit, gave Travellini enough time to run a very, very long distance out there in right field.
Yeah, it was kind of in the shallow right center gap. Definitely a tough play for him, but again, great speed on Travellini, able to get there and able to hold Bamford at second, which is also a big deal if this ball finds its way out of the infield.
And now with two outs, Cool can just focus on the batter, not worry about the runner, get the batter out, get out of the inning.
At the plate is Kyle Perry, the catcher, the number 2 hitter for the Hawks. And he takes a called strike to start off his at-bat. 5-1 here in favor of the Monmouth Hawks as they've come into Bob Hanna Stadium and had a big second inning and nothing since.
Now Perry at the plate is leading Monmouth in strikeouts, and I'm sure Cool would love to get one of those right now.
Yeah, well, that one misses 1-1, but yeah, he needs one because he just needs kind of something for a psyche booster, if nothing else, just to kind of pump himself up as he gets out of this fourth inning.
And right now I'm not sure if he would trust anything into his defense. He's definitely trying to put it on himself.
The 1-1, that one's hit on the ground up the middle. Niggerberger is there, fields it, throws over to first. And with that, we are out of the inning for Delaware. Bottom of the fourth coming up. Make sure to join us at lunch every other Tuesday at 1 p.m. for our social media chat show, Blue Hens Lunch Break. Student athletes and coaches, take your questions live right here on Hens All Access. The next episode, which is coming up this upcoming Tuesday, will be with the new athletic director, Eric Ziadi. as he will join you. He'll answer all your questions and much, much more as he'll join Jimmy Smith for the Blue Hens Lunch Break.
Actually, I will be sitting down
with
the Director of Athletics and Recreation, Eric Ziotti, this Tuesday. So make sure everyone tunes into that for our Blue Hens Lunch Break.
All right, well, Delaware now will have to, again, good inning by Cool. He did have to make an extra play courtesy of Ryan Hartley, but he was able to keep the runs off the board, and that's the important part. You're still trailing by four. You're heading into the fourth inning. You know, this is kind of that gray area when you get your starting pitchers because you either have guys who can go the 4-5 or you guys who can go the 6-7. And with Andrew McGee coming in at 0-1 with a 6.75 ERA, he looks like more of a 4-5 kind of guy. So this is where you can kind of take advantage, you know, see if you can kind of get a longer inning going and do some damage if you go.
What they have to do is they have to see pitches. They're letting McGee sneak away three pitch at-bats. That's something you can't do, especially for a pitcher, as you said, that's, you know, one of those 4 or 5 guys that isn't used to going deep into games. You need to make him throw pitches. You need to see pitches, and then you need to take advantage of it.
Well, stepping up for Delaware is going to be Tyler Powell, the left fielder, the cleanup hitter. As he'll be followed by Zach Lopes, the designated hitter, and then Cameron Travellini, the right fielder. McGee gets set to start off his work in this fourth inning, and he's going to miss inside. Quick one to know. Remember, coming up at the top of the fifth, we will have our trivia question. Again, if you've forgotten, it is, who is the career leader in home runs for the Blue Hens? We'll give you that answer at the top of the fifth inning, as this one is popped up towards shallow right field, and it is going to fall into the glove of Dan Shea, who comes over, makes the catch, and there is one away.
Powell, yet again, just not getting a good swing on the ball early in the count. That's not what Delaware needs. They need to make McGee throw pitches.
I mean, that was even a foul ball, so it really was not a good piece at all. And like we just were talking about, if you want to have a good inning, you're getting into that kind of gray area with the starter. This is when you could start doing it. Delaware not starting off on the right foot here.
Let's see if Lopes can see a couple more pitches, put a good swing on him. On a pitch hopefully later in the count after he's seen a few of his pitches.
Lopes doing the DHing this afternoon in the 5-hole. Will take his first pitch high and outside, 1-0.
Lopes is another Delaware kid. He was actually represented Wilmington in the Little League World Series back in 03.
So you did your homework.
He is Delaware through and through.
As the 1-0 misses inside, count goes to 2-0.
He is Delaware born, Delaware bred, and now he's back representing the Blue Hens in the college baseball arena.
So here we go, the 2-0 now to Lopes. Is a blooper into right field. Again, Shea is going to settle under this one. Much easier play for Dan Shea, and there's two away for the Blue Hens here in the bottom of the fourth inning.
Third pitch of the at-bat. The count was 2 balls, no strikes. Puts, a weak swing out to right field.
If it was 0-2, at least you have an excuse. 2-0, you need a better pitch than that if you're gonna be the designated hitter. Go ahead.
In a 2-0 situation, he has to see his pitch to really take a good swing on it.
Yeah,
that obviously wasn't his pitch. Didn't put a good swing on it.
Yeah, it was kind of inside out of it. Looped it weakly into right field. But that's going to bring up Cameron Travellini, the right fielder, the only one who's done any sort of damage this afternoon with the big triple into right center. And his first pitch will get very close to the inside part.
And he's also been working out there in right field. He's putting his mark on both offensive and defensive parts of this game. And let's see if he's able to increase that mark a little bit here.
Yeah, that one I was going to catch the bottom part of the zone. Count's going to go even at 1-1. But again, 2 outs. You see McGee come out here. He had a much shorter rest again. And the top half of the fourth inning comes out and he's firing on all cylinders so far today.
With a lot of help from the Delaware Blue Hen batters.
Yeah, well, absolutely. But the 1-1 is called a second strike. So the count runs to 1-2. And yes, Delaware's helped him out a lot considering Chad Cole's gotten virtually no help from the Hawks. The 1-2 from McGee. Drill up the middle, so Travellini goes 2-for-2. And he's going to be on first with a base hit to center field. A great piece of hitting there from Travellini. He's behind 1-2. He gets the pitch. Clearly that was a mistake pitch from McGee, and he just drilled it right back up the box.
Travellini is seeing something he likes in McGee's pitching.
Yeah.
And he needs to share that secret because he is absolutely smoking.
Yeah, go back and tell your friends. That's pretty much the message on that one.
And we've brought up his speed before. Now he's on the base pass. Let's see if he gets to cause a little havoc with 2 outs here to McGee. Get inside his head as he takes his lead from first.
Hartley, the third baseman, is at the plate. He takes a big cut and misses strike one. Listen, Hartley needs a hit more than anybody because this guy has not had a good day so far. Some serious troubles defensively. Didn't do much his previous at-bat either.
And that big cut was trying to make up for all those errors in one swing.
Yeah, you don't need to hit a home run here, but he does need to keep this inning alive as they're going to just check on over to Travellini at first. The count stays at 0-1. You have Hartley at the plate. Burgess, if we can get to him on deck. And Nigarugga is in the hole. The 0-1. McGee delivers, and it is drilled to left field. That was down the line. It's going to one-hop, two-hop defense. Travellini's going to round second, round third. He's going to head home. Hartley's going to stop at second, and Delaware has added on another run. 5-2 now is the lead, is the score. Monmouth still leading by three. There you go. Just like we were talking about, Hartley needed a big thing to make up for what he had done defensively last inning. And there you go, a drive down the left field line.
And that was all started by Travellini, who continues his success, and then Hartley gets a chance to make up for his errors in the field and absolutely smokes one down the left field line. And I don't know if you noticed this, but it seems like every time a Blue Hen gets a hit, they're kind of flapping their chicken wings a little bit as they stand up. That was, it's kind of become
is that their new thing now?
It's become a little thing. You see everyone as they come out of the dugout to celebrate. They're flapping their chicken wings a little bit, just like an old school chicken dance.
Well, with that, Hartley will get credit for a double and an RBI. And that's going to bring up Andrew Burgess, the catcher.
I like that they're having a little fun out there.
We're having a lot of comments here in the press box. Everybody complaining about what he's saying. You don't like the chicken dance comment?
The peanut gallery is not liking the chicken dance comment. I like that the Blue Hens are having fun. They're getting finally putting some points on the board, cutting into that deficit a little bit.
Points, runs,
goals.
The score is 5-2, whatever you want to call it. 5-2 Hens. You have Hartley on second base, two outs. Burgess at the plate, and he's going to foul the 1-0 back. Count run even to 1-1 here with two outs. Tim, they're just giving us a hard time.
They are.
On deck, Brock Nigarugga, followed by the top of the lineup for Delaware.
Burgess here has done a good job behind the plate, and now we're going to see if he can take advantage of a little of that momentum and bring it to the offensive side of the plate.
The 1-1 as McGee gets set. Takes a long look, and we're going to have time on the field as he just wasn't comfortable with the lead that Hartley was taking at second, and we'll reset.
McGee is definitely taking his time out there on the mound.
Here comes Seth, the 1-1, and that one is shot into center field. Bamford will settle under it, and that'll do it for the fourth inning. So we're going to step aside. Delaware gets one across, but still trail 5-2 as we head to the top of the fifth when we come back right here on Hens All Access. Welcome back into Bob Hanna Stadium. Delaware trailing 5-2 as we get set for the top of the fifth inning here as the Blue Hens are taking on the Hawks of Monmouth University. And as we promised, our trivia question was, who is the career leader in home runs for the Hens? And Tim, you believe you have the answer. I think you looked at the sheet.
I knew it before I looked at the sheet. I did look at the sheet, but I had it in my head already. He's one of the best players in Delaware history, one of the best players in college baseball history.
Yes, and he even made his dent in the major league level. But let's take a look at the answer. Kevin Mench.
71 home runs. That is
and
a lot.
Passed.
And he passed current head coach Jim Sherman.
There you go. So the more you know.
The more you know.
The more you know as he passed current head coach Jim Sherman. And now as we head in to the top of the fifth inning, Chad Cool still out there for the Hens. We don't see any work in the bullpen, so it looks like this is all him. The first pitch is drilled foul by Jake Grunsky, the second baseman, who is leading off. On deck is Chris Parrott, and John Guida is in the hole.
Both Sherman and Mench are members of the Delaware Athletics Hall of Fame. Fun fact.
The more you know.
The more you know.
The 0-1 fouled back as well. So ahead, again, ahead quickly. 0-2 for Chad Cool. The infield actually playing very far back, at least the middle infield, standing all the way by the edge of the grass there. As Grunsky, the three-hitter, has had some success so far this afternoon.
They're definitely not respecting his speed with their depths in the infield.
And the 0-2 misses well outside, and you hate to say the same thing over and over again. But if you're Chad Cool, you got to be able to punch out batters quicker than he's been doing.
And he's been doing a great job setting up the hitters on the first two pitches of an at-bat. He just hasn't been able to really, like you said, punch him out, slam that door.
That one is drilled to center. Chiquino has to run back. Great catch over his shoulder there, as that will retire the first out of the inning.
Chiquino.
Quick one away here for the Blue Hens.
Chiquino shows up that speed. Delaware in their outfield right now has tremendous speed. They don't always have it sometimes when, you know, their traditional outfielders are out there, but right now there's tremendous speed, and they can cover a lot of ground.
So with that, there's a one out. That brings to the plate Chris Parrott, the first baseman. And so he'll be up with one out, nobody on.
And again, Cool is operating quickly.
Right. You see, he deals that first pitch strike. I mean, he's probably, I'd say, close to 90% on that first pitch strike. But now, we talked about the infield being deep. Look at how shallow the outfield is actually playing. So they must have something in the reports as the 0-1 comes across for an 0-2.
They do not want to give up another bloop. Even after Chiquino had a run basically straight back on that last play, they're still playing extremely shallow.
You have
to think
the wind obviously plays a factor. Mm-hmm. And so if you're playing shallow and it gets held up in the wind, it kind of gives you that extra split second to go a little bit deeper if need be. But that 0-2 again misses, again 1-2. As Cool will try to punch out his second of the inning. As a 1-2 in the dirt as well. Good job back behind the plate for Andrew Burgess.
Cool, again, letting the batter back in without really earning their way back into the at-bat.
Yeah, as Burgess, not an everyday catcher for the Blue Hens, getting a lot of work here earlier on. But now we get a called strike three as Cool is able to set him down.
Cool settling in now. This is the pitcher we expected to see earlier in the game. He's settling down and mowing down a couple hitters, showing that powerful stuff that made him the number one draft prospect in the CAA.
All right, Parrott went down. That was the fifth pitch of the at-bat, so it was a good job by Cool to kind of keep it under control. 2-2 is understandable. And that was going to bring up John Guida now with two outs and nobody on. This one's chopped on the ground to Hartley. He's going to field, take his time, fire across the diamond, and thankfully for his sake, pulls that one off. So that is the end of the top of the fifth inning. And now,
if you guys want more, make sure to follow us on Twitter and get live updates and scores at twitter.com/UDBlueHens. For all your Blue Hen needs.
Whatever they may be.
So
Delaware still trailing 5-2 here. They were able, again, another quick inning from Chad Cool. He's obviously settled down, kind of brushed that second inning mess out of his head. Slowly piecing together this one run every other inning. Not going to cut it for Delaware. So they're going to have to do something now. We have a big part of the order coming up, which is definitely important to note. But now if you're Delaware, I mean, you have Niggerbugger up, then you have the top of the order with Chiquino, Long, Yezo. Mm-hmm. If you're going to do it now. Again, as we've been talking about, this is not a deep into the game pitcher in McGee. So now's the time to strike.
Yeah, exactly. Eventually, they're going to have to strike. And we keep saying now's the time. But now we're getting to the point of the game where there isn't going to be a next time. These batters might not get another at-bat.
Right. And you know what? I was looking through my numbers. And when you head after six innings for Delaware, they're 3-3 this year. If they were leading after the sixth inning, they're 3-0. When they were trailing after the sixth inning, they're 0-3. So that right there says you basically got six outs left on the offensive side if your numbers are going to stay true.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously you don't want to constrain yourself to that, but you got to kind of put some pressure on Monmouth now.
And that's a little bit of a testament to their bullpen, as you know, they have the closers and everything when they're ahead to shut it out. But at the same time,
bullpen struggles are a whole different story. We'll get to that once the bullpen gets into this game, if they do. But yeah, I agree. This is definitely something that Delaware needs to get moving on rather quickly.
They need to make a move quickly.
First pitch to Niggerbugger is inside. Call is 1-0. As Brock swings at the second pitch, this one is driven to right field.
Oh,
Dan Shea can't handle it. He misread it in the wind. It's going to fall in. Niggerbugger's going to trot into second base. And so that's going to actually be ruled a hit, as Shea just completely misread it. The wind clearly got a hold of that one. He was coming in and ended up about 30 feet behind him.
And the wind gets credit for the hit on that one, I think, because
yeah, you know what? If you're Delaware, you'll take it.
Exactly.
Absolutely. They'll take it now. And that's a leadoff double. Their first leadoff hit all afternoon.
And it couldn't come from a better position in the lineup, as now we get to the top of the lineup with the nine hitter sitting on second.
And you know what? You see it in both teams here. Your nine hitter is not necessarily your weakest hitter. Your nine hitter is the guy to turn the table, as they
say,
and kind of restart, re-jump your offense. And that's what you get here at Knickerbocker with the leadoff double. You saw it on Monmouth's side with Bamford, as this one's drilled to first base. Giacchino is out at first, but with that, Knickerbocker will trot over to third.
And that's nothing.
So he advances
a
runner.
Yeah, that's nothing but a hard hit bunt in baseball terms, I guess you could say, as the first baseman gets the put out, but the runner advances, and now he's at third.
But that's exactly what you want to do, because there were no outs. You move the runner over, you hit it to the right side of the diamond, which allows Knickerbocker to trot over to third. It's just a smart baseball play, and now you have DJ Long. Again, as we've been saying, the kind of pillar of consistency for this Wuhan team, an easy RBI waiting for him just 90 feet away.
He really just has to put the ball in play and get it out of, you know, the inner part of the infield.
As he takes a big swing at that first pitch, he'll be fouled back on one. But yeah, all he has to do is get it out of the infield. Even, you know, if he keeps it in the infield to the right side, he could probably still get the run.
Anything to a gap that makes them run a little bit with the speed on third base, he'll be able to get home.
On deck is Jimmy Yezzo, the big bat for the Hens. As the 0-1 is popped up foul out of play, first base side, and the count runs to 0-2.
And if DJ Long can get on base here and get Yezzo a shot to get rolling a little bit, this could be the start of a rally that gets them back in the game and gets maybe takes a chunk out of this three-run deficit.
Long gets set in the box. The 0-2, McGee delivers. And is fouled back. We'll stay at 0-2 and reset.
Long is battling here. He's just missing on a lot of these foul balls, almost coming straight back.
Now, when you're straight back, you just know that you're right on it, which is definitely a positive sign. But if you're DJ Long, going to the right side of the field, like we said, would not be the worst thing, as long as you know you don't hit it too hard to the point where Knickerbocker doesn't have time to get down the line. The 0-2 misses outside as McGee tries to paint the corner there.
McGee has to know that if you're going to go to the corner, you go to the left corner.
Right. Oh, yeah.
That's where it's been. That's where we're getting the calls all day.
This umpire has pretty much laid out a roadmap for pitchers, and McGee tried to be a hero there. But now with the 1-2, Long steps back into the box, and McGee delivers. And this one is drilled. It's going to drive in the run, if nothing else. Bamford coming over from center to make the play in left center. And Knickerbocker will easily score with no play at the plate. So Delaware pushes another one across as they inch closer, 5-3 now. Monmouth leads the Blue Hens.
And it seems that the Blue Hens are content to just nickel and dime their way back into this game.
One at a time, piece by piece, they're going to just try to push their way back into this game. They're going to have to rely on Cool to continue doing what he's doing on the mound. But now you have Jimmy Yezzo with two outs, nobody on, not the best situation you want for your power hitter. But you know what? Obviously, you have McGee not having as much success as he's been having in the early innings. So maybe this is a time for Jimmy Yezzo to strike.
And there he does.
Just that. And with that, he continues his hit streak to 18 consecutive games for Jimmy Yezzo. And a first pitch base hit right up the middle. And the streak continues.
Dating back to last season, 18 games.
To May 12th of last season.
Yezzo has been really in a groove, I guess you could say. And it shows
he's
line drive up the middle.
Really well out of the pitcher's hands. Obviously, it helps when you have McGee, who's clearly, like we said, slowing down.
And that was the last person McGee wanted to see, as you know, he's given up a couple hits here. They've been seeing him better. The last person he wanted to see was Yezzo step into that box.
Yeah, I mean, he hit it right up the middle, too, so he was dead on it. As this one is a weak chopper from Tyler Powell back to the mound. A fireball from McGee as he decides to get out of this inning himself. And with that, we will head to the sixth inning. Delaware pushes one more across. 5-3 now. Delaware trails to Monmouth Hawks. You are watching Hens All Access. We'll be right back after this.
Newark Charter School is launching its new high school, and it's going to be a college preparatory school. The University of Delaware is our neighbor, and we'd like to begin to have our students start thinking of themselves as future college students at the university. They've never experienced anything like this yet at Newark Charter School, so just the whole idea of being up close with people that they probably consider celebrities, which would be University of Delaware athletes, is going to be something they're going to be talking about for a long time.
this is their future. This could be their future, that, you know, if they stay focused and mingle athletics or whatever their team might be, that this is, you know, a possibility for them.
But the things you take away from sports, leadership, working together, and staying focused and determined. You heard it all from Devon, you heard it all from Elena. You guys can do anything you put your minds to. You can use sports as a vehicle to great success, but at the end of the day, it's all about working together, being part of a team, and it looks like we have some really great teams here.
Welcome back in, as we are at Bob Hanna Stadium for the Delaware home opener. Delaware push one across in the bottom of the fifth as we head to the sixth inning. Hens is trailing the Monmouth Hawks 5-3.
And as you just saw, a great event that has just occurred recently. A couple of the Delaware athletes were able to get down to Newark Charter School, headlined by Elena Deladon and Devon Sadler as they move into their postseason basketball season. But also, we had Chiquino, our center fielder here today, and Sean Banner were there just making the kids day and giving back a little bit.
Yeah, and speaking of basketball, if you can get down to the Bob, you definitely want to. You have the men's senior day, I guess you could say, tomorrow. So that's Saturday. And then you have the women's finish out their schedule Sunday afternoon, as well as Wednesday night will be their senior night for the ladies. So, you know, these teams are obviously heading into the postseason. Big, big hopes for both the men's and the women's basketball teams. As Delaware men's side were able to lock up the second seed in the CAA, women have already clinched the one seed in their conference. So a lot of high hopes.
As you said, the hopes are high. And as they go into they're expecting a lot of big things, both in the conference tournament and maybe even a little bit after for the women and the men as well.
Yeah, I mean, listen, obviously there's the AQ, the automatic qualifier that comes out of the CAA. But you know what? The men would love to, if they can't get that, they'd love to make some noise in the NIT. The women, I'm sure, being ranked in the top 20 nationally now.
Yeah.
You know, I'm sure they'll see some NCAA big moments as they get to play the first and second round here at the Bob. So a lot of basketball coming up in the next few months. Baseball is just getting underway.
Exactly. Delaware sports don't really get much of a rest here as they overlap a little bit.
They overlap, to say the least. But all right, here we go. Top of the sixth inning. As Delaware gets set, Danny Avella is stepping in, the designated hitter for Monmouth. Chad Cool still out there for the Blue Hens, as he's been cooking lately. He's been getting out of innings rather quickly with little help on the defensive end, but he's doing it himself, and that's what counts. As that first pitch misses, 1-0.
As long as he gets out of the inning without what happened in the second, where it got away from him a little bit, he's been absolutely on fire.
The 1-0 misses as well. The count runs to 2-0. And now you kind of see the opposite, of what we expected from Chad Cool after his previous couple innings. As a 2-0 off speed gets Avella way out in front, so he swings ahead to 2-1.
It's worth mentioning that despite the five runs that have actually been given up, Cool is working on only two earned runs. So he himself has been pitching a pretty decent game.
Yeah, I mean, he has a great game going. If you cross out the three unearned, I mean, you have two runs through five-plus innings. That's a solid day, and he's still going. And the 2-2 is a swinging strike three. So now he goes in reverse and solves his problem. Maybe he has to throw the balls first instead of the strikes. And Cool gets a strikeout to start off the sixth. And with one away, Owen Stewart will
start. Those last three pitches were absolute gems.
they were fancy. But now you see Chad Cool kind of getting into that little bit of a rhythm. He had the shoulder shrug there, maybe getting a little bit more comfortable up on the bump. And with one out and nobody on, Owen Stewart steps up, the third baseman, followed by Dan Shea. First pitch is popped up into right field, shallow right. Travellini giving chase near the line. He'll make the catch just on the other side of foul play. And that'll be the second out. So a quick one pitch out.
That is what he needs to do. He's pounding the strike zone, and he's not giving them anything to hit hard. He's throwing good pitches. Last four pitches have been absolutely exceptional.
Now we have two outs. Like I said, Dan Shea stepping in, the right fielder on deck, Joe Bamford. And then the top of the order for Monmouth, the first pitch, big swing and a strike.
And so far, Cool has had Shea's number.
Yeah, and Cool seems to be figuring it all out. Like we said, he threw those first two balls to start off this inning, but now he is cruising in this top of the sixth. Missing. Yeah. Wow, that was a close one. But Cool just misses. The count runs even at 1-1.
Burgess again held it there a little bit, gave the umpire a little bit of time to see the call he made before he moved on with throwing it back to the pitcher.
And so the roadmap has failed us. The 1-1 misses on the outside part of the plate. The count goes to 2-1. As now the outside corner, or the left corner, rather, is not nearly as consistent as it once was. The 2-1 now.
And he gets inside. On the right corner.
Yeah, so now we're flipping things around. He decides sixth inning, time to change things up. So 2-2 count.
Cool is keeping us guessing, and so is the umpire.
The 2-2, two outs. Cool gets set and delivers, and this one's hit on the ground to long. And that couple hops, fields it, throws over to Yezo, and we are out of the top of the sixth.
That was not a good swing by Shea. Even though he made contact, he still wasn't a solid swing. Cool won that at
right. He had the two strikes he had to protect, and he just had the weak chopper to second base. Remember, become a fan on Facebook for post-game videos, pictures, stories, and much, much more. That's at facebook.com/DelawareBlueHens. And under the University of Delaware Athletic Fund, the Blue Hen Club is the annual fund for UD Athletics. Annual contributions to the Blue Hen Club go directly for providing UD Athletic teams with the resources they need to compete for championships. Call 302-831-6276 or visit online at www.udaf.udel.edu and join today. But as we head to the bottom of the sixth inning, Chad Cool got out of it in style, and it looks like they are comfortable with Andrew McGee and this two-run lead.
They are letting McGee work. They're letting him, you know, kind of work his way through some jams, work his way through some hiccups, but he's still out there on the mound, still pitching well for the Monmouth Hawks.
Yeah, it's just out of your screen there, but down the right field line, you see Monmouth taking a jog to the bullpen and back. As they're just keeping everybody on the bench loose, making sure everybody kind of stays warm and limber, because you never know who you're going to need down the stretch here as this become a much closer and tighter ballgame.
This game has, it's kind of been a tale of two halves, but it's switched slowly with the nickel and dime offense of the Delaware Blue Hens.
Tale of two halves. My friend, football is over. First pitch to Zach Lopes is a called strike. As Lopes steps in, the designated hitter batting fifth today, Cameron Travellini, is on deck. He's been doing some serious damage so far this afternoon. And I would not be surprised, although there is actually, yes, there is some action in the Monmouth bullpen. Nobody throwing yet, but a couple guys stretching. I would not be surprised if Travellini comes up, you don't see McGee's day come to an end.
Yeah, that would make a lot of sense, especially the way Travellini has kind of had his number, owned him a little bit earlier in this game.
The 0-2 of the Lopes is a swung on strike three. And Zach Lopes goes down, so a quick three-pitch out for McGee. So maybe not. If he can get rid of Lopes that quickly, maybe they feel comfortable enough to leave him in for Travellini, who has clearly had his number.
Come on, Trav. Let's go, kid.
Travellini steps back in after 2-for-2 on the day.
Yeah, two great hits. He had the triple into the right center field gap and then directly up the box into center field. The base hit his last time up, his first pitch now from McGee. He's going to lay down the bunt. Did not see that coming. McGee's going to get over, shuffle his feet with the flip, and make the play.
And that's an athletic play by McGee to get down there.
That's a questionable decision altogether. You have somebody who has been stroking today. He had two outstanding hits. He had clearly had McGee's number, as you said. Uh-huh. And now you're Jim Sherman. You tell him to lay down a bunt.
I mean, maybe he's trying to think a couple steps ahead in the chess. It seems like he'd be the one you want to swing away.
Yeah.
But if he would have reached, we would have been saying it was a genius call.
Yeah, true. But all right, here is Ryan Hartley, the third baseman, who was able to kind of clear some of his woes his last time up. This time he pops it straight up at the plate. Standing there is Kyle Perry. He's going to make the catch. So Hartley, as I was saying, was able to do big things his last time up. He doesn't do much this time. And a quick 1-2-3 for Monmouth.
That is a quick inning for the Delaware offense, and that is not what we needed.
All right, well, we are going to send it down now to Jen DeLuca, who's standing by with Coach Jim Sherman.
Thanks, guys. Checking in with Head Coach Jim Sherman. So, you, Cool got off to a great start with the 1-2-3 in the first inning. Written to the defense on the second. He came back aggressive in the third. You're only down by three right now. What do you need to see from your team to turn this game around?
Well, we got to catch the ball when it's needed. Turn double plays, catch a humpback fly ball. Get base hits when runners are in scoring position. That's all, and we'll get back in the game.
You had a couple big hits from Cameron Travellini and Brock Niggebrugger. What can you say about your hitters today?
Well, Travis is swinging the bat pretty well. Other than that, nobody's really swinging the bat, so we got to get it going.
Okay, well, thanks. Best luck for the rest of the game.
Thank you, Jen. They're talking with Coach Jim Sherman just a little while ago about how this one has been going. Delaware trailing 5-3. That last inning, obviously, was not part of the conversation, but not a good one. And Delaware went down 1-2-3 as now McGee, who we thought was kind of tapering off, has clearly gotten just back into the saddle, to say the least. But Delaware now sent Chad Cool back out there. They have some action in the bullpen, it looks like. But Cool at least starts this top of the seventh inning with the Hens trailing by 2.
Cool comes into this inning with 6 strikeouts today already. His career high is 10 last season, so we'll see if he's able to add to that total.
Well, he will start with Joe Bamford, the number 9 hitter, the center fielder for the Hawks, and then the top of the order. First pitch is a called strike, and it looks like the umpire has decided to go back to his favorite left corner. The 0-1, Cool gets set and delivers. And
back
same
to the
spot, same story. 0-2.
If it's not broke, why fix it, Chad?
Exactly. 0-2 now as Bamford is behind the count. Cool, try to punch him out and cannot. Just misses the outside corner. They're going to ask for the check swing appeal, and it will be denied. So it'll go to 1-2. And so Bamford gets to live another day. Cool gets set with the 1-2. As this one's in the dirt, almost got away.
And this has kind of become the theme of the day for Chad Cool here. Get up, get ahead in the count. Let him right back in with two more balls.
Yeah, and then last inning, when he fell behind the count, he was able to respond with 3 great pitches. So Cool, a little twisted today. As this 2-2 pitch is drilled to right field, Cameron Travellini is right there to make the catch.
There's Travellini, the star of the game so far for the Bullpen.
Yeah, so Travellini able to make the play. And the first out of the seventh inning.
That might have been the easiest out of Travellini's day. Smoked right at him, but went out nonetheless.
So we get to the top of the order for the Hawks. Steve Bogus is stepping in for Monmouth as his first pitch will be inside. 1-0. On deck is Kyle Perry, the catcher. As this one is drilled to right. Travellini's got to get on his horse for this one. Looks like it's going to go over the fence and out of here. Home run Monmouth. They extend their lead nearly 6-3 off the solo shot.
Comes from the leadoff hit of the now that's something you don't expect. Can't be happy with that.
Right down the line. Yeah. More power there. Bogus. Turn on. And extend the lead to 3-1 once again for the Monmouth Hawks.
And the wind is blowing in that direction. He might have got some bounces. Nothing.
Now stepping in is Kyle. He's got to catch two hits here. It's cool. Just really his first big blow.
Yeah.
Really, she's got a sweet grounder, back-to-back, step off field, throw over. And the second out is made. Over there with Jimmy Yezzo at first base.
I like that again. It was a base run, home run. Settles down. Gets a nice ground, right back, fields it, throws it to Yezzo. That's what you need, veteran, of course. And real ace pitcher.
Yep, and that's how they got right there. They play by Cool. Now they have two outs. Jake Krutzke is in the box. Number three, hitting second baseman. First pitch outside corner. Strike. Strike. 0-1. Two outs here. 6-3 lead. And this one is thrown right to the right field line. Traveling all the way back to the wall. And now Grutsky is on his horse to trot it to second base.
He turned first, going for two. Settle in, double.
Traveling is busy out there in right field, getting out, watching the sail over and chasing down that line drive right there. He's working hard and making more hard.
Grutsky ends the inning. Cool now has a runner on second, bring up Chris Parrott, first baseman, still two outs, two outs, two outs, Parrott is the main focus of Chad Cool.
He's not worried about the run on second, he just has to get the batter out and ending this inning.
first pitch is fouled down the first base line. Now this guy is Coach Sherman just saw a home run and a solid drill down the right field line, and he stayed on the bench, didn't even go out to say anything. Catcher didn't. They have a lot of faith in Chad Cool and helping him get out of this bad situation.
And that speaks to his mental makeup. The coach trusts him to not let mistakes compound and really get out of this inning.
The 0-1 for Cool. Is that inside? Count levels of 1-1.
Regardless of his mental makeup, I would guess this is his last inning. We're starting to see some activity down there in the Delaware bullpen.
Solid 7 innings from Cool to get out of this one. I'm sure that would be his high so far this season. Was 7 2/3. I just don't see any need for him to go in to the eighth inning. That one's drilled down the right field line, foul out of play. So Cal State 1-2 as Cool tried to get out of the seventh inning.
He is one strike away from his second consecutive seven-inning outing. That's impressive for Chad Cool.
Yeah, I mean, that's what you expect from the workhorse. Yeah, he's got up within the innings. He's got it. It's nothing else. Give your bullpen a few extra days off or a few less guys needed in a game. And now we'll see if he can complete the seventh right here. 2-1-2 from Cool. Call, strike three on the outside corner. And Chad Cool gets out of the seventh and probably gets out of his day. But after 6.5, Monmouth gets an extra run on the solo shot by Steve Wilgus, and they extend their lead to 6-3 over the Delaware Blue Hens heading in to the bottom of the seventh inning. Make sure to check out Blue Hens Beat, our bi-weekly web show dedicated to everything Delaware athletics, with features, highlights, interviews, and more. Blue Hens Beat will give you behind the scenes that you need. Look for a new episode now on BlueHens.com.
Now you see both teams sending people out of the bullpen to run around, kind of warm up, do some stretching. It's getting cold out here. It's getting windy, and both coaches are worried about their teams.
Yeah, you see Monmouth down the first base line. They're circling up. They're doing jumping jacks.
They're circling and doing jumping jacks.
In the bullpen for Delaware,
we have Jeff Paglioni, sophomore right-handed pitcher from Manchester. Oh, no, that's Monmouth.
I'm not looking at the same thing as you. Luke Alinkovich.
Alinkovich. A sophomore right-handed.
I butchered that. I apologize.
A sophomore, thank you. Sophomore right-handed pitcher from Kennett Square, Pennsylvania.
Most likely, if we could ever get his name figured out, he'll come in the top of the eighth. I'd be genuinely surprised. But nonetheless, Delaware will get set to go here as they send Andrew Burgess, the catcher, to start off this inning. He's the eighth hitter, and him followed by Niggerbrugge, and then the top of the order with Chiquino.
Also up in the Delaware bullpen, we have number 15, Eric Sawyer, a sophomore left-handed pitcher. So
Delaware's got some youth in the bullpen warming up right now.
Maybe some right-hand, left-hand situations coming up. They have one of each up in the bullpen.
So as we said, after six innings, Delaware winning. They're 3-0, trailing their 0-3. So for their sake, they hope that streak ends today. Yeah, but that first pitch is a called strike on Burgess, 0-1.
Burgess needs to be the catalyst to a rally here. He needs to get on base.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, you have Burgess, you have Niggerbrugge, who's been solid all day as that one's popped up behind first base in foul territory. All the way coming over is Grunsky.
That is
great play by him to track that one all the way down to make the catch. That's the first out, but that is not what we want.
That is not the catalyst I was looking for.
But as I was trying to say, you have Niggerbrugge in the top of the order, but now that's kind of deflated. You're going to have to do it now with one out already against you.
Niggerbrugge needs to find a way on base, just like
the rest of the Hens. Yeah, just about like the rest now. 6-3, Monmouth.
Someone needs to get on base
in the first of three games here in this weekend series. Still dealing is McGee. That first pitch popped up to shallow center. Bamford giving chase, and he's going to be called off by Grunsky. So Grunsky covering a lot of ground here in these first two batters, and he has two outs to his name. And Delaware now has two outs in the bottom of the seventh.
And the Blue Hens are they're definitely showing their aggressiveness, swinging early in the count. Another first pitch pop up there. They're trying to kind of force the issue a little bit as we move into the later innings.
So now we get to the top of the order. If you're going to do it, you got to start now, I guess. You have the top of the order. This is your prime situation, although it is two outs. But Chiquino will have to get going. DJ Long on deck. His first pitch, an off-speed called strike on the outside part. 0-1.
Chiquino has the speed to where if he gets on base, he can force the issue as well. He can make some things happen and get in scoring position for the heart of this order coming up.
The 0-1 from McGee misses low and away in the dirt. And the count runs even at 1-1. The 1-1 now. McGee delivers. And you can't really the outside corner, 1-2. This is the most inside-outside, inconsistent outside corner I've seen in a long time.
You can't understate what McGee's doing out there. He came in with an ERA well over 6.
And the 1-2 is fouled off down the third baseline out of play.
And now he is absolutely dealing to the Delaware Blue Hens.
0-1, 6.75 ERA. That is not somebody you expect to struggle against. But he's held Delaware to 3 runs, and his Monmouth Hawks have given him this 3-run cushion here in the bottom of the 7th. 6-3 Hawks lead. And the 1-2. This one chopped weakly on the ground to third base. Stewart backhands, throws across the diamond. Just gets him by a step, not even. You see the umpire running away after he made that call. He might not be so sure about it. But with that, we will step aside. Delaware trailing 6-3 after 7. And you're watching.
Jim Sherman is going to make sure he goes out and has a conversation with that umpire.
Yeah, absolutely. But you are watching Blue Hens Baseball right here. We'll be right back. Welcome back into Bob Hanna Stadium here as we head into the 8th inning. Chad Kuhl still on the mound as Delaware trails 6-3. Jake Wickman joined alongside Tim Donnelly right here for Blue Hen home opener baseball. As Jim Sherman just now walking off the field after that discussion, like you kind of alluded to before the break, he had some words for the umpire on that last call.
As soon as the umpire made the call, he ran away from the first base coach.
He was heading to center field. I don't know where he was going.
He did not want to talk to the first base coach, so Jim Sherman made sure that the conversation was had. If you're not going to talk to my coach, you're going to talk to me. Went out and personally asked him some questions about that last call on the Jagino ground out.
Well, up for Monmouth is John Guida, the shortstop, the 5-hitter. And like I said, Chad Kuhl's still out there. They have faith in him. And his first pitch is a called strike. I'm sure his leash is very short. As you said, we have a righty and a lefty warming up in the bullpen for Delaware. So this could just be a matchup situation thing that Sherman is now going to try to play with.
But
the 0-1 is fouled back.
It's worth noting his career high, 7 2/3 innings. He's coming out here. If he gets the first out, 7 1/3, he's creeping up on it.
Yeah, I mean, if he can cruise, I don't see you're not going to pull him for no reason unless you really have a very specific matchup. But I feel like in an out-of-conference game, how specific can the matchups really be?
Yeah. You don't have the scouting that you have on a traditional conference opponent. But you also, you know, you want to protect your horse. He is your guy, so you don't want to leave him out there too long.
The 0-2 from Kuhl is hit on the ground. Niggerberger is there. He'll take it on a couple hops to the backhand, throws it in the dirt. Yezzo scoops, and there's one away.
It's a nice pitch by Kuhl there, showing that into the 8th inning he can get it done.
And he does get it done. Gets that first out on 3 quick pitches. And now stepping in is Danny Avella, the designated hitter. With one out, nobody on. Monmouth still leading 6-3. As except for the solo shot last inning, Chad Kuhl's been outstanding if you cross out that and the entire second
inning. It is a very isolated incident.
Yes.
That have
sporadic kind of blips on the radar, if you will, of some issues that have led to this 6-3 lead for Monmouth. As the 1-0 misses down low as well, 2-0. For Avella. Kuhl gets set. The 2-0. It's a called strike.
And Kuhl, his demeanor is not saying take me out. His demeanor is saying let me go the distance. He is up there still working quickly, still throwing hard, still getting it done.
If you're a starting pitcher, you don't care what the score, what the situation is. You don't ever want to come out of a game. And this left field shot is hit to Tyler Powell. He'll make the catch, and that'll be 2-2. So now we have tied Chad Kuhl's season high in innings pitched. And from the looks of it, he's going to try to break it.
They're going
to
let him go for his season high.
Stepping in is Owen Stewart, the third baseman, the number 7 hitter. I feel like that also plays a part in it. You're down towards the bottom of the lineup. You have Stewart, you have Shea, you have Bamford. These are guys that you feel Kuhl has handled well all day. Mm-hmm. You might as well let him try and finish out this 7th inning.
I'm sure in between innings, Sherman had a conversation with him that went something like, are you good? And he said, yes, I'm good. And that's all you needed to know. That is all
you
ever
said, no, I'm not good to take yourself out of the game.
I'm not. It's part of the coaching job. You have to gauge the goods. Yeah. Some goods sound different than other goods.
I absolutely agree. And the 0-1 is a swung on and missed 0-2.
Another great pitch by Cool. He actually looks like he's better this inning than he has been in the most recent few.
Yeah, Cool is definitely dealing. He fell behind early in that first batter, but seems to respond. Every time he did that, he did that two innings ago as well, fell behind early and responded in tremendous style. And this one's now going to be lined right at DJ Long. And with that, Chad Cool has completed eight innings of work. No runs scored, no hits, a 1-2-3 inning for Cool and the Hens. And we head to the bottom of the eighth, 6-3 in favor of the Monmouth Hawks. We'll step aside. Blue Hens Baseball will be right back after this.
My honor to introduce our new head coach, Dave Brock.
I'm going to love Delaware football. I'm confident that we have the building blocks in place to win in 2013 and forward. We'll be a program that the entire state will be proud of on and off the field. With this opportunity comes tremendous responsibility. I will fulfill that responsibility. Together we will. Thank you very much.
Well, welcome back in to Blue Hen Baseball here, the home opener for the Delaware Blue Hens. They come in at 3-3. They're taking on the Monmouth Hawks. And the Hawks have given them some trouble. They lead 6-3 here as we head into the bottom of the eighth. Delaware is at the 2-3-4 spot in the lineup. You know what? We've been saying it virtually every inning for the last three or four innings. If you're going to do it, do it now. Do it now. I mean, they still have the same pitcher. You still have Andrew McGee out there. I don't see any excuses for Delaware to not try to crack this one open right now.
You have to wonder if you're going to start seeing Nick Ferdinand, E.J. Stoltzfus, Ty Warrington right, coming in a pitch-out scenario.
As his first pitch is swung on hard by Long and a sky-high pop-up in the middle of the infield. Everybody kind of dancing around. Grunsky will finally come down to make the catch. That one held up there for a while.
The wind definitely held that up. But Coach Sherman has to see that the batters who are in the lineup as of now aren't really getting good wood on the ball aside from Travellini. So maybe you let a Ferdinand, you let a Stoltzfus, a Warrington, who's gotten the day off, come in and try and spark the team to a three-run comeback, which isn't anything too insane.
Listen, it's not out of reach
of
what's doable. And, you know, if it's still considered a save opportunity, because this first pitch is fouled out, if it's still considered a save opportunity, it's still a winnable game. That's
exactly
how we were always told to look at it when I played. And listen, it's a 6-3 game. You're here in the bottom of the eighth. You're coming up to the hardy order. You have your number three hitter up with one out.
Yep.
Get it going.
Exactly. That's kind of the sentiment. You have to get it going at some point.
Yezo on the 0-1. Drills this one back over our heads in the press box. And the count goes to 0-2.
And it is worth noting that Yezo has already extended his hitting streak to 18, so he doesn't have that pressure. He's just up there trying to win a ball game.
He's, of course, chasing Carlos Alonso, who has the longest hit streak in Delaware Blue Hens history, over 30 games for Alonso as the 0-2 is in the dirt, 1-2. I believe 32.
Is that so? You've done your homework, obviously,
well,
on this one.
You pulled out the Little League World Series stat. That threw me for for a whirl there. But here we go. The 1-2 to Yezo with one out, nobody on. And McGee still dealing. Takes his time and now gets set. Just high, and the count runs even at 2-2.
And if we're talking milestones being chased, DJ Long has a couple within reach. He needs 10 doubles to get the most in UD history with 71, or 32 games to reach 200 in his career, which is pretty rare.
Oh, we're going miles now. All right, well, the 2-2 misses, 3-2. I'm not going to try to outstat here. Okay, but Jim Sherman is going for his 362nd win.
Okay. Is he? Is that so?
The full count to Yezo as he's going to try to keep this inning, get this inning going.
Our statisticians are working on it.
He's here right up the middle, a base hit for Jimmy Yezo, and that's another multi-hit game for him. And I actually do have a stat on that, but I'm not going to pull it out just yet. That would just seem obnoxious. But Yezo gets on with a one-out single up to center field. That's going to bring up Tyler Powell, the cleanup hitter, with a runner on first and one away.
And Yezo doing his best to get a rally started here. Let's see if Tyler Powell can continue the momentum, put some good wood on the ball, and advance Yezo a little bit.
Again, you know, you have some action in the Monmouth bullpen. McGee still out there as he's looking to complete eight innings as well. The first pitch, a called strike right over the middle.
a little bit of a anything you can do, I can do better going on with the pitchers here. If you're coming out for the next inning, I'm coming out for the next inning. We might see some complete games.
That would be something. He's saying at a conference complete game. I'd be shocked. But here we go. The 0-1 misses inside 1-1. So the count runs to 1-1. You have one out, and you have Jimmy Yezo on first base. Not exactly the definition of speed over there, but you do what you can here, down three in the later part of these ball games. The 1-1 swung on hard and missed. Count goes to 1-2. On deck is Zach Lopes, designated hitter, followed by the only one who's really had a lot of success, Cameron Travellini, in the hole.
I think it would be a great situation to get a few people on base and get Travellini to the plate. That could be something that gets them back into this game.
McGee taking his time on the hill, the 1-2. He gets his signal and comes set. Stares down Yezo, and now delivers, and this one's chopped on the ground towards short. Guida's going to field a flip to second for one over to first in time. And Monmouth gets out of it with the double play. And that will send us to the ninth inning. Delaware trailing 6-3. Had a runner on, couldn't do much with it. We're going to step aside. Blue Hens baseball heading to the ninth when we come back. Welcome back in as we head to the ninth inning of Blue Hens baseball right here on Hens All Access. Jake Lickman and Tim Donnelly, Hens trailing 6-3. They have a pitching change. We finally saw the end of Chad Cool's day. Eric Sawyer steps on the mound for Delaware.
Eric Sawyer is a sophomore out of Mechanicsburg, Pennsylvania. Hasn't seen much action this year. He has two-thirds of an inning pitched, and his ERA is up around 14. So let's hope he can lower that a little bit in this ninth inning.
Well, if you're Delaware, you're trailing by three. I understand the whole concept of getting people opportunities.
Yeah.
I wouldn't exactly consider this one of those windows. But, you know, obviously we didn't see that game. Yeah. What the actual situation was.
Yeah. He pitched two-thirds. There was a lot of earned runs in there. So we're not going to bring up his last stat. We're just going to let him know that he's got a three-run deficit to work with and he needs to get out of this inning.
Your Blue Hens support you, sir. That's all we got for you. But here we go. Top of the ninth inning. Due up is Dan Shea, the right fielder, then Joe Bamford. And we get back to the top for the Monmouth Hawks with Steve Wilgus in the hole. Steve Wilgus, of course, his last time up. The solo shot that once again extended this to a 3-1 game. And that was back in the seventh inning.
And we'll see what the young Eric Sawyer can do here. Doesn't have much experience, but I guess that's why he's in here, to gain some experience. So we'll see how he handles this situation.
I mean, again, this is out-of-conference play. You never want to chalk a game up to not being important.
Yep.
But at the same time, if you want to get your pitchers to get some work in, not use all your, you know, A guys, if you will, this is a good time to do it. And, again, this is still also a three-game series this weekend. Yeah. So plenty more baseball against these Hawks to come.
And I like that move by Burgess, the catcher, going out there, just settling him down, letting him know that they're on the same page.
Right. Just time to go to work. Don't worry about the score. But here we go. The first pitch from Sawyer. Misses outside 1-0. Again, Dan Shea is at the plate, the number 8 hitter and right fielder.
And it's a good batter for him to start with because Shea has not had much success today.
Sawyer comes set and just misses the outside corner, runs to 2-0. Burgess was trying to help him out there a little bit by holding it, but could not convince the umpire to change his decision.
Sawyer must have been paying attention because he was trying to beat that left side of the plate that has been
was told before he went out there. Drill that left corner. It'll work for you. But he misses again and falls behind 3-0. And now this is exactly what you don't want. Yep. Delaware's obviously going to have to do something offensively in the bottom of the ninth if they want to stand a chance. And the last thing you need is a long, drawn-out inning by a reliever.
Yep.
And the 3-0 just gets the corner and keeps him in this one, 3-1.
Shea is definitely going to make Sawyer throw strikes here before he...
You kind of see him crowding the plate a little bit here on this 3-1 pitch. And Sawyer has no fear, goes inside, evens it out. Good job there by Eric Sawyer. Just as I said that, he kind of just went right in on him.
The young pitcher showing a little bit of a veteran moxie
guts,
there.
Yeah. Dan Shea kind of hovering, if you will, as the 3-2 is chopped back up the middle. Long's going to come over, and Niggerberger tried to cut him off. And it's going to be ruled a hit, as neither of them were able to come up with the play. That just looked like confusion.
Yep.
And Niggerberger couldn't really field it, but they'll give him a hit anyway. And it'll be a leadoff base hit for the Hawks. And with nobody out and one on, Joe Bamford will step up.
A little bit of confusion there in the middle infielders, both from Delaware, DJ Long and Niggerberger, both looked like they kind of wanted the play, and neither was able to come up with it.
So now Sawyer will have to go to work with a runner on first. He is a lefty, which works to his advantage a little bit when it comes to pickoff moves. So was Chad Cool, of course. But now Bamford, showing bunt right away. He's going to lay down that first pitch. And Sawyer tried to pick it up too quickly. He wanted to go to second to start a double play. Couldn't get it out of his glove. So we'll take the easy out at first. And there's one away with a runner on second for the top of the Monmouth order. And Steve Wilgus comes to the plate.
Again, the young player showing a little veteran savvy there. Wanted to go to second. Juggles it a little bit. Doesn't panic. Just gets the sure out at first. Gets one down. First one's always the hardest. And now we can move on to the next batter.
Right. One out runner on second. It's not a terrible situation to be in. You could definitely get out of this inning without him crossing the plate.
Again, he's just dealing with the runner at the plate.
So Wilgus steps in. His last time up, the home run right down the right field line. A big swing, trying to follow that up with another one.
He wanted to.
Behind 0-1.
He wanted to back up his home run with another.
Sawyer taking his time now with the 0-1. And Wilgus shows bunt, pulls back, and will be called for the second strike. Interesting decision. You know, you're up 3 runs. You're showing bunt. Obviously, they're going with the advance the runner concept, the small ball play. But what would you really do with a runner on third and 2 outs? I mean, it's not like you need that run. Yes, it'd be nice to extend the lead, but it's not necessary to the extent that you got to sacrifice guys at this point.
I think Monmouth is just trying to kind of get inside the head of the young pitcher. They're crowding the plate excessively. They're showing bunt, pulling back. I think they're just trying to give him a lot of different looks and make him throw strikes in difficult situations.
Yeah, and you see Sawyer try to get that outside corner once again. Just missed. So the count goes to 1-2 with one out. He has Dan Shea, rather, over there on second. As that one's in the dirt. Good job by Burgess to keep it in front of him. Keeps the runner where he is. And the count goes even at 2-2.
Burgess has had a good game behind the plate. Nothing too eventful, but a couple stop balls on low pitches in the dirt.
And now Eric Sawyer again, just kind of taking his time, making sure him and Burgess are on the same page. Gets his signal and delivers a 2-2. This one's chopped back foul directly behind home plate. Stay at 2-2 and we'll reset. One out here in the top of the ninth inning. Delaware trailing the Monmouth Hawks 6-3 in their home opener of this 2013 campaign.
I think that goes along with being the home opener. It's very early in the season. You know, a 6-3 deficit to a Monmouth team early in the season isn't that big a deal in the big picture. You just want to see your team compete. You want to see them make plays. And you want to see Eric Sawyer, you know, pitcher.
Out.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
Well, he got one there as Hartley came across from third base, made a good play on the hop. And there is 2 outs. The runner did advance to third, rather, as Shea now always just 90 feet away. But Kyle Perry is up with 2 outs here in the top of the ninth. And this potential 7th run on third base. And now with that, we're going to see a pitching change from the Blue Hens. Sawyer's day is done. He got 2 of the 3 guys out, so not a terrible day. It'll help his ERA.
It'll help his ERA exponentially.
As long as I can strand that guy over there at third. And we'll see who comes in.
Alec Novich was warming up. We'll let you know if he is the choice to come back in.
And it looks like it's going to be Luke Alec Novich coming in, the sophomore right-hander, the 5'10", 180. Coming out of Kennett Square, Pennsylvania. So now he'll get some time for his warm-ups.
He's coming in. He has 2 1/3 innings pitched this season, and his ERA is actually at 0. He has yet to allow an earned run. So let's hope he continues that here today, giving up a little over 300 to his average to his opponents. but he has yet to give up a run, which is always good.
Which is always good, and of course, with that seventh run just 90 feet away, he'll have to make sure to keep that in check. The sidearm slinger here in Alec Novich. But just remember, under the University of Delaware Athletic Fund, the Blue Hen Club is the annual fund for UD athletics. Annual contributions to the Blue Hen Club go directly toward providing UD athletic teams with the resources they need to compete for championships. Call 302-831-6276 or visit online at www.udaf.udel.edu and join today.
You brought up Alec Novich's sidearm slinger. Last season, he wasn't. He was an over-the-top guy. This offseason, he switched to a sidearm motion. So it's new for him. It's a new look for his teammates as well as the opponent.
As far as this standoff is concerned, I think you just won right there. How'd you even find that? But I don't know who's in your ear, but okay. With that, Alec Novich will take just a few more warm-up pitches, and it looks like we're all set to go. Kyle Perry will step in, the catcher, the number two hitter, who's done some damage today. Not too much, but again, two outs here in the ninth inning. You want to make sure Alec Novich can get out of this inning, get the hands back to the bats, and then they have to do it because it's now or never as we head to the bottom of the ninth.
We've been saying it all day, they have to do it. This next inning, they actually have to do it.
They kind of had to do it, but now they have to do it.
Yeah.
So here we go. Perry steps in. Runner's actually on second. Check that, not on third. He did not advance on that previous play. I thought he did, but I guess because I'm watching a different game. But on the first pitch, that's driven into center field. It's going to be cut off immediately by Giacchino. He's going to throw in. It'll be cut off by Yezzo. They're going to have a play at second, and they're going to get him out at second. Perry caught trying to get two, but the run will count. And with that, the lead is extended as we head to the bottom of the ninth, 7-3. The RBI pays off for Kyle Perry.
And that run will be credited to Eric Sawyer. So,
all right, well, we helped his ERA a little bit.
He did help his ERA. It's just you would have loved to see that run not count on the play at second.
All right, well, with that, we will step aside. Bottom of the ninth, coming up when we come back right here with Blue Hens Baseball. Con los terroristas. Welcome back in to Bob Hanna Stadium here as we head to the bottom of the ninth inning. Jake Lickman, Tim Donnelly with you as the Hens will try to start this four-run comeback. They trail the Monmouth Hawks 7-3 in the home opener of this 2013 season, and they will start with, is that the same? That is. They still have him out there. They're going to start with Andrew McGee on the mound for Monmouth, as I guess he is going to look for the complete game like we talked about.
He's going for an out-of-conference early season complete game. Pretty rare in the college baseball world, but he is going to go for it. He's filling himself, so he's just going to try and finish it off.
All right, and for our next game here on Hens All Access, it will be tomorrow afternoon. The Blue Hens men's hoop squad celebrates senior day versus George Mason. That is their final game of the regular season. Of course, the CAA tournament starts next weekend. Next Saturday is, in fact, their first game. They'll be taking on Hofstra in round one. And again, on Hens All Access, tomorrow afternoon, you have men's basketball against George Mason.
You get to see a record-breaking senior in his last home game, Jamel Higgins, career leader in rebounds, blocks, and numerous other statistics.
And our next baseball broadcast is going to be March 6th against Delaware State. That's this coming Wednesday, again at 2:30, right here on Hens All Access. That first pitch was fouled back and out of play.
McGee is still looking strong. For someone who came in with a 0-1 record and a 6.75 ERA, this has been a very surprising effort by Andrew McGee out there on the mound.
And Zach Lopes, who was at the plate, doesn't need a hitter, fouls that one back as well. It falls to 0-2.
Lopes needs to make his move here. He's down 0-2 in the count, and they can't really afford any outs at this point in time, down 3 with only 3 outs left to go.
And the 0-2 just misses. Count goes to 1-2. Lopes caught a little bit of a break there, just missing low.
That was a very gutsy no-swing there by Lopes.
McGee gets set and deals inside. Whoa. A little close as McGee brings the count even to 2-2. Lopes just out of the way of that one.
McGee keeping the intensity deep into the ninth inning.
At this point, you might even want to step into one of those, kind of get something going.
Don't move your thigh as much.
Here's a 2-2. That one, a weak half swing into shallow right field, and it will fall in for a base hit. And so the half swing, I guess you'd call that, for Lopes, falls in. And Delaware has their leadoff man on here in the ninth inning.
And that is a break that Delaware absolutely needed. A little Texas League blooper, a little Bush League blooper right out over the second baseman's head. Gets Lopes on base as Trevellini, really the only person who's gotten really solid swings consistently all day, steps to the plate.
And it's the only one who kind of came out of the field house this afternoon. But as you saw, the second he stepped up to the plate, the coaches stepped out and backed up the right fielder in Dan Shea, because that seems to be where he's been going off of McGee this afternoon. So he's going to come up now with Lopes leading off the first, no outs in the bottom of the ninth as Delaware trails 7-3. That first pitch is swung on and fouled out of play on the right field side.
I think Trevellini is just really seeing the ball well. As you said, they backed up the right fielder, was actually opposite way for him, which means he's not fighting the ball. He's taking it where the pitch kind of directs him to, and he's just putting good wood on the ball.
You saw Lopes there down 1-2 in his last at-bat, so Delaware at least staying alive with these tough counts, still able to put runners on and keep this one going. The 0-1 now, Trevellini gets set, swings hard again, this one fouled directly back behind us. And the count once again goes to 0-2 in favor of Andrew McGee.
Good news for the Blue Hens, despite the 3-run deficit, ninth inning, you don't see any quit in this team. They're out there fighting as hard as they can. Lopes is down there on first, active in every pitch, and you know Trevellini is trying to get another hit.
Yeah, well, Trevellini, you know, his last at-bat, he was 2-for-2. They send him in there and have him bunt. Very questionable decision. But he's obviously swinging all lights green here in this ninth inning. The 0-2 on the outside part of the play called strike three. So Trevellini goes down. Looking, the Hens have their first out. And with Lopes on first, Ryan Hartley is at the plate, the third baseman who has struggled today.
He struggled in the field. He had a big hit, big RBI down the left field line. Earlier in the game, and he would love to see another big hit here and hopefully atone for a few of those miscues in the field.
So Hartley steps in. The first pitch from McGee gets the inside
right
corner.
Right along that left side of the plate.
Somebody may be getting a little cold back there. Might want to go home.
The umpire's trying to send this one to the car.
The 0-1 now from McGee is low.
That pitch looks extremely similar to the one before it.
I wasn't going to say it, but I'm glad you did. So now we're having a little coin toss down there. 1-1 is the count. As Andrew Burgess, the catcher, is on deck for Delaware. McGee deals a 1-1. That one in the dirt. Good job there by Kyle Perry to keep it in front of him, not let anybody move, as Lopes has to just trot back to first base. And the count goes to 2-1 now in favor of Hartley.
And Hartley is ahead in the count. He needs to be selective here, get a good pitch to hit, and put it in play. That needs to be his most important thing right now, is put it in play. No home runs. It's not necessary.
As 2-1 is a pitch out to make sure that Lopes doesn't go anywhere.
He just needs to make sure he puts his bat on the ball and see what happens once he gets in the field.
So 3-1 now. As if Hartley can get on, two runners on would be a great situation for Delaware, because that would at least bring them the opportunity to eventually tie this game up. But the 3-1, that one swung on and hit to center hard. Bamford is going to just kind of trot under it. It was hit hard, but hit right at Joe Bamford. And so that's going to be the second out of this inning. As Lopes goes back to first base, it's going to bring up Andrew Burgess.
There was a quick second out there when the ball was in the air where it got hung up in the wind a little bit. You didn't know if Bamford was going to be able to find his footing and get underneath it. But eventually, it was able to get under it, make a clean catch, and send Hartley back to the dugout.
So now you're down to your final out. If you're the Blue Hens, you have Andrew Burgess, your catcher, the eighth hitter at the plate. Again, you have Lopes on first base. McGee looking for the complete game. Deals that first pitch is lined to left field, and the Hens are not done yet. As the one pitch, one hit goes in the books for Burgess. And he keeps the afternoon alive. That brings up Brock Niggerbrugge, the shortstop, the number 9 guy. He's been turning the tables all day, and he would love to do that one more time and get back to the top of this order as Chiquino is on deck.
And now if you can get Niggerbrugge on base, you get the top of the order back up, as you said. And then you can really kind of get the makings of a two-out rally, which is a necessity at this point in the game with only two outs in the ninth inning, only one out left in the game for the Blue Hens.
Yeah, now you're going to see the small ball game come into effect. That looked like it was the Adam Davis who just checked into pinch run.
There was a pinch runner.
Yes,
it was Adam Davis.
Adam Davis is actually listed as a pitcher, but he's in there to pinch run nonetheless.
Yeah, he's in there to,
so the Hens have
first put some additional speed on the base pass.
I guess anything's better than your catcher, right? So first and second, two outs. As Niggerbrugge hits this one on the ground to short, they're going to go the easy way to second. And with that, the Hens drop their home opener 7-3 to the Monmouth Hawks. Delaware just could not get that rally going in the ninth with two guys on. We're going to step aside. When we come back, we will break this one down in the postgame show right here on Hens All Access. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Newark Charter School is launching its new high school, and it's going to be a college preparatory school. The University of Delaware is our neighbor, and we'd like to begin to have our students start thinking of themselves as future college students at the university. They've never experienced anything like this yet at Newark Charter School, so just the whole idea of being up close with people that they probably consider celebrities, which would be University of Delaware athletes, is going to be something they're going to be talking about for a long time.
This is their future. This could be their future, that, you know, if they stay focused and mingle athletics or whatever their team might be, that this is, you know, a possibility for them.
But the things you take away from sports, leadership, working together, and staying focused and determined. You heard it all from Devon. You heard it all from Elena. You guys can do anything you put your minds to. You can use sports as a vehicle to great success. But at the end of the day, it's all about working together, being part of a team, and it looks like we have some really great teams here.
Welcome back into Bob Hanna Stadium here as the Hens drop their home opener 7-3 to the Monmouth Hawks. Jake Lickman, Tim Donnelly with you in the postgame show. And unfortunately, Delaware just could not start their home season off on the right foot. They've never really been dynamite at home,
yep,
especially in the past few seasons. But not exactly how you want to start with your ace going and giving you a pretty solid effort.
They were never able to overcome that deficit they encountered in the second inning there. They got down 5 runs early. I tried to kind of nickel and dime the way back, little dink and dunk, run here, run there, but it wasn't able to ever culminate in actually catching up. Like you said, Cool was honorable on the mound, gave him a large chunk of innings, but they just weren't able to pull it out in the end.
Yeah, and Monmouth did a great job. I mean, they had 7 guys get hits. Mm-hmm. So, like you said, that second inning was tough. He let up the 5. Only 2 of them were earned. He ended up having 3 earned on the afternoon. But you got to give credit to Andrew McGee. I mean,
yeah,
the kid did work. He was 0-1 with a 6.75 coming in, and he did a complete game.
Complete game.
And held Delaware to just 3.
And you look at the heart of the order for Delaware, which is supposed to be, you know, where you get your runs from. DJ